Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the fourth meeting of the Net Zero Transport, Energy and Transport Committee for 2022, which we are conducting in hybrid format this week, with some members attending in person and other members attending remotely. At agenda item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda items 7 and 8 in private. Agenda item 7 is consideration of today's evidence, and agenda item 8 is the review of draft correspondence on carbon capture, utilisation and storage, which the committee took evidence on during December. Do we agree to take those items in private?
Yes.
We are agreed. Items 7 and 8 will be taken in private. Agenda item 2 is the consideration of a statutory instrument, the Greenhouse Gas Emissions Trading Scheme Amendment Order 2022 draft. I welcome Michael Matheson, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. He is joined by Matthew Costello, Head of Carbon Markets and ETS. And online is Mariana Cover, Policy Officer, Domestic Climate Change Division, Energy and Climate Change Directorate, Scottish Government. Good morning to you all. Thank you for joining the committee this morning. This is a joint instrument between the four UK administrations. It is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means that Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. I invite members to take note that later in this meeting, we will be taking a negative instrument, which is linked in policy terms to this affirmative instrument. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion to approve the instrument. With that in mind, I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement. Cabinet Secretary, over to you.
Good morning, Convener. Thank you very much. I'm pleased to give evidence today to support the draft affirmative instrument to amend the Greenhouse Gas Emissions Trading Scheme Order 2020. The UK ETS is a key policy for meeting Scotland's ambitious emissions targets. The scheme is a cap and trade system designed to limit overall emissions in the covered sectors and incentivise cost-effective decarbonisation. When the scheme was established in January 2021, the legislation dealt exclusively with issues essential to its initiation and continued operation. At the time, ministers from the four governments agreed to defer implementing some technical and operational aspects that were not immediately essential, with the intention of adding further provisions during the first year of operation. This is the purpose of the affirmative instrument I am presenting today and of the negative instrument laid simultaneously in Parliament. To be clear, the provisions in the affirmative instrument are designed to support the continued smooth operation of the UK ETS and deliver the existing policy intentions, rather than to fundamentally change the way it functions or it applies in Scotland. In broad terms, this instrument aims to clarify the powers of enforcement granted to the regulators, in Scotland's case, SEPA, and some of the enforcement actions available to them. It also extends enforcement powers to the registry administrator, that is, the Environment Agency. It makes an offence to intentionally obstruct a regulator in exercising powers of entry. It prevents double counting of excess emissions penalties that apply for some operators, and it gives the regulator powers to impose civil penalties on operators who fail to return allowances to which they are not entitled. Finally, while I'm unable to go into specifics today, given the ongoing discussions with the other administrations, I am confident that in the coming months we will be in a position to publish a joint consultation to explore further policy reforms to the UK ETS, as well as the Common Framework Agreement. At that point, I'd be more than happy to return to the committee, should they wish, in order to discuss the matter in greater detail.
Thank you very much for that statement, Cabinet Secretary. We'll now move on to questions from members, and I see that Mark Ruskell has a question. So, Mark, I'll hand over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. A couple of quick questions from myself. I mean, firstly, is the UK ETS performing as we'd hoped that it would perform? And secondly, there was discussion, I think, about a year, 2 years ago, about UK government introducing a carbon tax. And I'm not sure if that was ever actually put to bed, whether that was still under development or whether now UK ETS effectively removes that option off the table.
So on the first point, yep, it's performing in the way in which it was intended. There has and also across the four nations. There have been discussions in recent months to consider whether we had to make some adjustments to it, and there was a decision made across the four nations not to make any adjustments to the capping levels, given some of the pressures that sectors are experiencing with energy prices. So by and large, it's operating in the way in which it was intended. It clearly has to change and adapt for the future, which is the work that we are taking forward on a four nations basis, and as I mentioned, that we hopefully we'll be in a position where we can consult on that in the months ahead. But by and large, it's operating the way in which it was intended. In relation to a UK carbon tax, I'm not aware of where the UK government are at on the implementation of a carbon tax. It clearly would have potential implications for the ETS. Given the discussions we've been having with BEIS over the future of the ETS, at no point has it been flagged up that actually there may be a carbon tax coming in that would actually render the ETS scheme no longer viable. So on the basis of the discussions that we've been having with the UK government, there's been no indication of implementing a taxing regime that would replace the existing ETS. What this effectively does is it aligns us more closely to the EU emissions trading scheme. I don't know if Matthew, if there's anything further you would add to that.
Are there any other questions from members? There are no more questions, so we will move to agenda item 3, which is the formal consideration of motion 02605, calling for the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee to recommend approval of the Greenhouse Gas Emissions Trading Scheme Amendment Order 2022. I therefore invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak to and or move this motion.
Moved, convener.
Thank you very much. Let me just check to see if there are any further contributions from members. I don't think there are. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to sum up and make any final comments on the instrument?
Nothing further to add, convener.
That's great. So the question now is that motion 02605 in the name of Michael Matheson, MSP, be approved. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. The committee will report on the outcome of this instrument in due course, and I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve a draft report for publication. Thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary, thank you for bringing this motion to the committee. I will now briefly suspend the meeting for the next agenda item and allow officials supporting the Cabinet Secretary for the next agenda item to join us. Thank you. Welcome back. For our next agenda item, we will take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary in relation to the draft budget, which will be finalised in the days and weeks ahead. We have Scottish Government officials joining us and joining the Cabinet Secretary. We have Kerry Twyman, Ian Freeman, Simon Fuller and Ross Miller. Thank you for joining us this morning. Cabinet Secretary, I believe you would like to make a short opening statement. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, for inviting me to give evidence on the Net Zero Energy and Transport Portfolio Budget for 2022-23. The portfolio draws together many of the key strands required to deliver on this Government's ambitious and world-leading plans around climate change. The portfolio budget and policy areas will ensure significant progress is made in delivering the commitments embedded in the Programme for Government and the Bute House Agreement, enabling the Scottish Government to successfully meet its statutory climate targets and protect the natural environment, whilst continuing to support the most vulnerable in society and deliver a safe, accessible and affordable public transport system. Our ambitious 2022-2023 budget requires a sea change in the direction of government expenditure, with reprioritisation towards programmes that underpin our move to a green agenda, covering all aspects of the portfolio: the natural environment, public transport, active travel, energy and climate change. In the budget, we are spending over £3.4 billion on transport, including investment of almost £1.4 billion to maintain, improve and decarbonise Scotland's rail network, and £414 million to support bus services and their users through concessionary travel schemes, including the extension of free bus travel for young persons aged under 22. We'll provide a record level of investment in walking, wheeling and cycling, increasing to £150 million, an increase of 30% from the 2021-2022 figure. We're also providing record investment to protect and restore nature, including our peatlands, and to tackle the causes of biodiversity loss. We will also continue to support our forestry bodies to deliver the Woodlands Creation Target, which will see 15,000 hectares of new planting in 2022-23. We recognise the substantial investment is needed to deliver our waste and recycling targets, and in this year's budget we are investing over £43 million to drive Scotland's circular economy, which will reduce reliance on scarce resources and reduce waste. And we are committed to taking strong action to meet the climate challenge and are investing almost £50 million on climate action, including £20 million for the Just Transition Fund to accelerate the development of transformed and decarbonised economy in the North East and Moray. Finally, we will continue to provide significant budget for energy to support heat decarbonisation, to make our homes and buildings warmer, greener and more energy efficient, including increasing funding to help support the fuel poor through heat transition. Convener, this portfolio's budget delivers on an ambitious agenda, but it's not without risks, such as the ongoing impact of COVID on the public transport system and the uncertainty around demand-led schemes, such as the Under 22 Concessionary Travel Scheme. I can, however, reassure the committee that I will continue to reprioritise within my budget to not only mirror legal, statutory and contractual commitments, but to achieve value for money against the backdrop of a challenging fiscal position. And I'm more than happy to respond to any questions the committee members may have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And we will now move on to questions. Let me have the first question. As you will know, this committee is undertaking a major inquiry into the role of local authorities and cross-sector partners in delivering net zero. Last week, the President of COSLA warned that the Scottish Government budget settlement for local authorities will lead to a reduction of a quarter of £1 billion in core funding, which they have expressed concerns about in terms of their ability to deliver their responsibilities. A few weeks ago, we heard from five different council leaders representing local authorities across Scotland about the challenges they face in delivering net zero targets. Let me highlight brief extracts of the evidence they provided. They agreed that councils should drive delivery of net zero, but they need finance with which to do that. Another said, "We do not have enough funding in place to move forward at the pace that is required." And the leader of Highlands Council said the following: "We have had 10 years or more of cuts to local government budgets. What is missing is the resource within local government to respond to net zero targets." Do you recognise these significant capacity, resource and financial constraints at local government level? And do you share the concerns of various council leaders that budget cuts will significantly impact their ability to deliver national net zero targets?
On your last question, no, not necessarily, but I recognise the pressures that the public sector are facing, not just at a central government level, but also at a local government level. And the particular challenges that then creates for our colleagues in local government. As the Finance Secretary said it last week, we have delivered as fair a funding package for local government as we are able to do in the challenging financial environment in which we are operating. But I think it's also worth keeping in mind is that local authorities have faced financial challenges for a number of years, and they've been making very good progress in actually tackling climate change and some of the reductions they've seen in the emissions that they've committed to, which have been significant over recent years. So I think I recognise and understand there will be challenges for them, but I don't necessarily that doesn't necessarily mean that they won't be able to make progress on tackling climate change. If I pick up on a couple of examples of where local authorities will benefit from investment, for example, on active travel, which will have a significant benefit in local communities. It will help to tackle congestion potentially in towns and cities across the country. And the budget line in that area is increasing substantially in order to help to support the rollout of active travel. Alongside that, the investment we're putting into the decarbonisation of heating systems and improving energy efficiency will have a marked improvement on the social housing stock, some of which local authorities are responsible for managing as well. Again, that's an area where budgets are increasing in order to help to improve tackling issues around decarbonisation of heating and also energy efficiency as well. So I think I understand and recognise the challenges which they face, but I don't accept that doesn't mean that they'll not be able to make progress in tackling some of the climate change challenges which we face, and also some of the investment we're making at a national level will have benefits at a local level as well.
Thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary. You mentioned decarbonisation of heating, and that's another area local authorities gave evidence on. Let me provide you with some of their feedback on this. The local authorities told us there has been a lack of strategic consultation and dialogue with the Scottish Government in this area. There's a lack of detailed guidance on what is required of local authorities. We heard concerns over the scale of investment projects available within local authority areas, as well as the expertise available to meet the 2030 targets, and concerns over the ability to attract private sector investment that will be required in this area. Again, do you recognise these concerns, and what urgent steps are being taken to address these issues? Because some of the local authorities expressed serious doubts as to whether they could meet the 2030 targets that have been set by the Scottish Government in this area. And one brief question in this area, what role will the Public Energy Agency and the Green Energy Task Force play in assisting local authorities to meet these targets?
So let me just unpack some of the issues in there. So we've not long published our heat decarbonisation strategy, which was formed following a public consultation, including with our colleagues in local government, who had an opportunity to feed into that particular process and are able to continue to feed into our policy development in this area. So I don't accept the idea that local authorities have not had an opportunity to help to feed into national policy direction and our national strategy in this, because it was an open consultation for them to participate in and to feed into, which they've been able to do. The second thing is that we commissioned some specific work which was carried out, which involved housing associations, and I think if I recall correctly as well, was the I think it may have been the Chief Executive of Inverclyde Council to look at some of the specific challenges which local authorities faced around the heat decarbonisation agenda. That was a report which was submitted to the Scottish Government last year, which fed into the development of our strategy. So again, they've been involved in helping to formulate that policy and our thinking around it and some of the challenges which we face on it. The other point I would make is that I recognise the scale and nature of this challenge is extremely significant for not just local authorities, but our social housing providers. There are hundreds of social housing providers across the country who will all face similar challenges. which is exactly why we committed to setting up the Public Energy Agency to help to support local authorities, to help to support social housing providers, to bring together the skills and expertise and to develop the advice and information that they require to assist them in moving forward with this whole agenda, and to ensure that we don't find ourselves in a situation where we have 32 local authorities all trying to do it different ways and reinventing the wheel over and over again. So that's one of the purposes behind the Public Energy Agency, is to help to coordinate that, provide expertise and help to provide the guidance and support that is necessary. And your final point in terms of the Green Financing Task Force, which we are setting up, I hope in the next couple of weeks we'll be able to set out the details of both its remit and also those who will be members of it. But again, that's specifically being designed to look at how we can lever in external financial support alongside public sector investment in the heat decarbonisation agenda to support colleagues in both the public and private sector of housing. So they'll have an opportunity to feed into that process, and I would expect local authorities to have a role in that task force to ensure that their voice is heard very right at the very heart of developing any recommendations for government and taking it forward.
And one very brief question on the Public Energy Agency. Has additional budget been provided for that agency in the current Scottish Government budget?
I think from the it's been managed internally within our own existing budgets. There's no specific ring-fence budget for it, but it's been managed within my own portfolio budget, and it's taken for account within our budget lines for this financial year.
Right, but it's still at the moment and for the time being a virtual agency. Does it have dedicated staffing and dedicated resource?
So there will be a dedicated team within the Scottish Government helping to draw that initially together with a view to then ramping up and developing the agency to be much more standalone, if you like, not entirely separate from government, standalone, so that it can actually carry out its work. But that's a couple of years away yet from the work that's necessary to get it up and running.
Okay, thank you very much. Let me pass over to Fiona Hislop.
Thank you and good morning. We face a twin crisis of climate change but also biodiversity. So I want to focus on the natural resources budget. The allocation is £29.8 million, but it's got to fund local nature networks, the restorations of Scotland's rainforests, commitment to 30%, a high target for land for nature by 2030, and a nature restoration fund which is £13.5 million, which is almost half of that whole fund. So that's in addition to reform of other areas, particularly in terms of wildlife management and also development of a new biodiversity strategy. So these are wide-ranging, they're multi-year commitments. It would be helpful to the committee if you could provide some kind of breakdown of spend in this particular area in 2022-23. And also, because of the importance of this biodiversity crisis, how do you see the profile of spend in this area over the next few years?
Okay, so I agree in terms of the twin crises which we face in terms of nature loss alongside climate change. Climate change driving quite a significant part of nature loss, of course. I think the first thing I would say in terms of our budget line on biodiversity and natural infrastructure has seen a significant increase in funding over recent years. It's a 55% increase overall that we have seen that includes what will be £55 million of new funding to extend the Nature Restoration Fund to £65 million, which of course, as you rightly say, is a multi-year fund. The fund will work across Scotland. Its objective is to help to create green jobs, to reinvigorate local communities, to reinforce Scotland's green recovery, and also to support large-scale, multi-year, multi-partner projects which can deliver transformative change. Part of the reason for this being a multi-year funding package is to give the sector reassurance of the level of funding which will be available in future years to allow some of these long-term projects to be taken forward, because many of the nature-based projects are long-term projects, and therefore a funding profile that gives assurance around that is the approach that we've sought to take with it. In terms of if there are further breakdowns on how that nature restoration fund will be utilised at a lower level. I'd be more than happy to take that away. I don't have that to hand, but I'd be more than happy to take that away and try and provide more detail if that would be helpful.
Yeah, so if I pick it up correctly, the £13.5 million is for this coming year, but there's a commitment of that larger £55 million to give certainty. That's helpful. Yeah. The second area I want to look at is in relation to peatland restoration. The UK Climate Change Committee stated in its 2021 annual progress report that the pathway requires 50,000 hectares of peatland to be restored per year from 2022. Now, currently the commitment is 20,000 per year. So how has that advice from the UK Climate Change Committee been factored into this year's funding allocation for peatland restoration? And again, some indication of what that might mean in future years as well.
So our commitment is to deliver 250,000 hectares of peatland restoration between now and 2030, which is on average around about 20,000 hectares 20,000 hectares a year that we are committed to taking forward. In 2020, we announced what was a 10-year package of funding to help to support this of some £250 million to deliver on that target. The budget this year provides some £23.7 million for peatland restoration, which is an increase on the last year's budget of some 8%. Since 2012, we've invested around £30 million. The figure of 50,000 is not taken for account into this year's budget because our target is the 250,000 between hectares between now and 2030. What we have asked is we've asked Nature Scott to carry out some analysis around the proposed figure, which has been set by the Committee on Climate Change, to consider where there are other innovative ways, other ways in which we could help to expand the existing target, which we have, in order to address the target which has been suggested by the Committee on Climate Change. That work has just been completed and submitted to government, which we're presently considering the recommendations of, which will then consider whether we have to make further investment and also whether we have to change our approach to peatland restoration from where we have been at the present moment, or where we are at the present moment. So this year's budget is based upon our 250,000 hectares target, and pending the recommendations from Nature Scott, we'll then look at whether we need to take further measures in order to help to extend our target and how we could go about potentially doing that.
So I'm sure the committee would like to hear about that report when it's available and how you intend to fund it, because clearly your budget meets the targets you've got. The issue is, are those targets sufficient for what's required? So I think that's the issue, is about the climate change kind of target as opposed to necessarily the budget. But I think a colleague might want to come in. Convener, back to you.
Thanks very much, Fiona. Yes, Mark Ruskell has a supplemental. Mark.
Yeah, it would certainly be good, I think, to take some more evidence on that Nature Scott report. But, I mean, as I understand it, the peatland restoration budget was underspent this year. So, you know, is there an issue here that we can keep putting more money in, but if there are other reasons why landowners are just not signing up to spend the money, or there's a lack of skilled workforce, or, I don't know, lack of equipment or whatever, we're going to continue to not meet the target for other reasons beyond budget?
I think there is an important point here. There is a capacity issue within the peatland restoration sector, and that is it's a fairly new sector. There is a limited number of companies or businesses who operate in this sector. There's also a very small window in which peatland restoration can take place each year, which means that very often businesses who are involved in peatland restoration do it as an add-on to other things that they're involved in as well, because it's not sustainable in its own right. I think it's a period in the sort of September-October period when the work has to be carried out. So it's a sector which is growing, and there are limitations on the skills which are available in the sector because of that, and also because it's not viable as a business on its own, given the very short time frame in which peat and restoration work can be carried out. So there are capacity issues within the industry. There are. I'm not so sure whether there's as much to do with those not being willing to take up the opportunity to restore peatland. I'm not saying that it's not an issue, but I'm not so sure that is one of the main issues. I suspect a big part of this will actually be access to skills and businesses able to flex into doing peatland restoration work for a very short period of time each year, which means taking their equipment and everything away from the other things that we'd normally do for that short window when it can be carried out.
Thank you, Mark and Fiona. Liam Kerr, to be followed by Natalie Dawn. Liam, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I have several quick questions just on data and measurement. First of all, how do you measure how far towards the 2030 climate goals the spending decisions that have been made in the 22-23 budget will actually take Scotland?
So we have there's a carbon assessment for the budget, which is carried out, which is a statutory requirement for each budget, which is published. The other part is the way in which we measure our progress against our climate change targets is through our climate change update plan, and the various portfolio envelopes that need to be progressed in order to make sure we're on track for 2030 and for 2045. So a combination of the carbon assessment, which is carried out for the budget, and our monitoring evaluation process for the climate change update plan, which we carry out going forward. If there is you'll be aware of the work that the Fraser Van Allender Institute are carrying out to look at how we can get greater transparency around the contribution that budgets make to meeting our climate change targets. I think it would be extremely helpful if we had a more robust and a more effective system for being able to monitor budget impact on our climate change targets, and hopefully the work that the Fraser Van Allender Institute produce will help us to develop a framework that will give us more transparency for the committee and for accountability to Parliament, but also will give us a greater insight into the direct impact. So I would say that's broadly the two areas that we rely upon at the present moment, both the update plan and also the carbon assessment carried out for the budget.
I'm very grateful. And taking it back a stage then, so you talked about moving funds to support the green agenda, and it's actually related to my friend Mark Ruskell's question just earlier. More generally, how do you measure or project what the prospects of achievement of each project will be, and whether the funding is sufficient to deliver that? And similarly, how do you measure or project the opportunity cost of the reduction in investment elsewhere?
Well, if you take something like the budget assessment around capital spend, around 92% of the capital spend within the budget is viewed as being low impact in carbon or neutral in carbon, which I think is an overall increase in terms of it's an overall reduction in carbon impact in a positive way. So that comes through the carbon assessment process for the budget itself. When it comes to individual projects, let's just take up peatland restoration. So our commitment to delivering on the 250,000 hectares is part of the sectoral envelope that we have for meeting our 2030 target, and is part of our climate change plan. So part of the assessment that the various envelopes went through in developing the climate change plan had to assess the impact individual policies would have in order to see whether they would align with needing to get to 75% by 2030. And that figure of 250,000 hectares was viewed as being one of the contributors to meeting that particular target. So I think there's a there's a there's a there's a link between the budget and the policy set within the climate change plan, and then the budget and helping to finance that, and the carbon assessment that's carried out for the budget allows us some insight to that. In terms of whether the whether removing funding from one area will have a positive impact, if you take, for example, if we remove funding from policy areas that we know contribute adversely to climate change, then it would seem to me that it's self-evident that it's going to have a and we use that funding for measures that will help to tackle climate change and achieve our target, then it's self-evident that we'll have a positive outcome for us and contribute towards meeting our targets. But it's always very difficult with individual projects to be able to pin down exactly the net benefit that will come from a particular project. As I say, for example, is peatland restoration. What will the we know it will have a positive impact, there's a level of assessment, but it can be very difficult over time to pin that down to how we shift money around in the budget and why that's made a bigger contribution than the money we've taken away from another area.
Thank you. I'll have one further question, Convener, but just very quickly. You mentioned in your opening remarks, Cabinet Secretary, the allocation of £20 million of the Just Transition Fund. Can you help the committee understand what or who precisely is that paying for or going to, and what are the measurable year one outcomes of that £20
million? So the fund doesn't sit directly in my portfolio, so it sits in finances portfolio, but the £20 million is some of the initial allocation to take forward work in developing the action plan that will deliver the transition plan for the North East and Moray. We've given a commitment to take that forward on a co-production basis, so that local stakeholders are able to shape how that funding will be used. So some of it will initially be to help to carry out that work, but then the way in which that money will then be allocated and utilised will be informed by the co-production basis that it's going to be taken forward and input from local stakeholders and how that will be shaped. And I would expect the details of that to be set out in the next financial year.
Thank you. No further questions.
Thank you very much, Liam. Natalie Dawn to be followed by Monica Lennon. Natalie, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Yeah, I note that we've got £43 million going into Scotland's circular economy for this year's budget, but we have some concerns with funding out with the Scottish Government's control. So the Circular Economy Investment Fund and the resource efficiency programmes are set to finish this budget year. And as far as I'm aware, there's no plan for how this funding is going to continue post-EU exit. Can you advise what impact would a drop-off of funding have on the circular economy and what the Scottish Government is doing to avoid a stalling of this? And also what asks of the UK Government in relation to the Shared Prosperity Fund that we have?
Well, in the last EU multi-year financial framework, Waste Scotland received that £34 million of European Regional Development Fund. Right now, Zero Waste Scotland are taking forward work to try and identify how they could bridge that loss of potential funding going forward, whether there are ways in which they could lever in private sector funding to try and help to close that gap. As it stands at the present moment, there's a lack of clarity around how the Shared Prosperity Fund will operate in Scotland, what its priorities will be, how they will be informed, who will set those priorities, will Scottish ministers have a role in setting those priorities, will it be a lower level of funding than was previously available under the EU regional development funding. So there's a lot of uncertainty around this. This is an area where we need to see more progress. We are not in line with the targets which we set. That's why we committed the extra £70 million to invest in a circular economy and recycling in particular. And we need to see further investments be made both in the public and private sector. So until we have clarity around how the Shared Prosperity Fund will operate, potentially this could be a significant loss to the sector if there's not funding available to replace the £34 million that was previously provided under the European Union funding scheme. And at this stage, we still don't know how the UK government intend to operate the Shared Prosperity Fund and what role Scottish ministers will have in setting its direction in Scotland. So potentially it would be a negative impact it would have in the sector.
It's extremely concerning, and you mentioned Zero Waste Scotland there. So funding for Zero Waste has been relatively stable on last year with a slight increase, but we're rapidly approaching the 2025 waste targets across landfill, recycling and food waste. And in some areas, progress has been slow, for example, in relation to the 70% recycling target. So within our inquiry, the committee's inquiry, we've heard from local authorities that there are difficulties in relation to recycling and the circular economy. And even last week, we were discussing the difficulties among the private and financial sectors and the need for a more central support, more sort of cohesive approach. So in terms of that, what are the top priorities for public and private investment in the coming year to ensure that we do have a chance of meeting those 2025 targets?
Well, I recognise that we've got a significant amount of work we need to do to get ourselves back on track in meeting these targets. They are tough targets, rightly so, and we need to do better in making sure that we are achieving them. And my colleague Lorna Slater is working hard in order to help to ensure that we are taking forward the right measures to do that, which is why we have set out the commitment to developing our waste route map. In order to make sure that we're very clear on the tangible progress we'll make over the next couple of years in order to get us on track. When you say that the budget in Zero Waste has been relatively stable, the budget is 8% higher at this financial year than it was in 2021. So we have been increasing our level of expenditure in this area over recent years, and alongside that we also made the commitment of £70 million for the Recycling Improvement Fund, of which some £20 million was allocated last year for a number of local authority partners to take forward strategic investments in recycling infrastructure. So I think it's not just about finance here. So the issue I also have about the circular economy is that we also need to see it as an economic opportunity. There are clear environmental benefits we get from greater recycling, but we also need to look at the economic opportunities which are associated with it. And through the route map that we're looking to develop and the work that we're taking forward in the portfolio around the circular economy and our intended circular economy bill is all about making sure that we seize not just the environmental benefits but also the economic benefits that can come from developing and expanding our circular economy overall.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I have no further questions, Convener. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Natalie. Let me bring in Monica Lennon to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Monica, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone. Cabinet 2022-23 budget document a commitment to allocate £23.5 million for the Green Jobs Fund. We had a session last year with Scottish Enterprise, so I wonder if you can provide an update on how green jobs are defined for this purpose, how the funding will be allocated, and further to that session with Scottish Enterprise, can you give us an update on how many applications have been received to the Green Jobs Fund and how many have been successful?
Okay, good morning. In terms of the Green Jobs Fund, so it's in two parts. So there is some £50 million which has been baselined for our enterprise agencies, and there is some £50 million which we hold at a government level where we are undertaking work with businesses to set the criteria which would allow businesses then to start applying for it in the new financial year in order to make sure that it's aligned with the needs within the sector. I should say, Convener, just for the record, is that this is not an area of policy that sits in my portfolio, so it sits with the Finance Secretary, but the approach that's been taken is to have it in two tranches, part run by the enterprise agencies and part at a national government level. And the work to set the criteria and the application process has been taken forward just now through engagement with the business sector in order to make sure that it's a fund that they feel aligns with the skills that they require in order to help us to deliver more green jobs. I can't give you the figures in terms of the enterprise agencies, but I'd be more than happy to take that away, convener, and to respond in writing to the committee if the committee would be content with that, to respond specifically to the point that Ms Lennon's making. On the issue around the definition of green jobs, there is no clear definition of what a green job is. There are competing views on what should be defined as a green job. So we're undertaking some work in Scottish Government through engagement with a variety of stakeholders to try and arrive at a shared and agreed position around what could be classified as a green job. There may be, for example, what we might classify as a green job might not necessarily be reflective of what other countries would consider to be a green job. So we need to make sure that we have an inclusive definition, but that's a piece of work that's been taken forward just now so that we have a shared and agreed understanding of what would be classified as a green job, which will then allow us to understand the progress we're making in delivering greater numbers of green jobs going forward.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That is helpful, and I appreciate it's not all within your portfolio, but I think knowing that there's a consistency in approach and some clarity is helpful. I'll move on to my next question then. Just last night, BBC disclosure documentary Dirty Business exposed the harmful impact of waste crime in Scotland to both people and the environment. And we know it's costing the public plus more than £50 million a year. Cabinet Secretary, CEPA has had a very difficult time, as you know, and the full financial impact of the cyber attack on the environment regulator is still not clear. However, we do know it has experienced serious operational disruption and the loss of internal systems and data. In this context, and in the context of the climate and nature emergency, is it appropriate for the draft budget to dish out a real terms cut to CEPA of more than 7%?
Thanks for that question. I didn't see the programme myself. I intend to watch it. I know that CEPA were promoting it just to highlight the complexities and the challenges within the sector. I think it would be fair to say that the change in the movement in CEPA's budget is a reflection of a capital uplift which they received last year, which was a one-off uplift, which is why there is a realignment within their budget, because if you look at their overall budget, the budget for the coming financial year is actually, if you take out what was that specific capital uplift that received, their budget is it still continues to rise. So it's also worth keeping in mind about 50% of CEPA's income also comes from its regulatory function and the charges it applies for its regulatory function. So I think it'd be wrong to characterise this as though it's a cut to their budget. It's a movement in their budget because last year they received a capital uplift specifically for a couple of projects which only sits within that single financial year. In relation to the cyber attack, so CEPA continued to make good progress in recovering from the cyber attack. There's been a range of assessments carried out on the impact it had on their operations and their recovery. One of the things that we're ensuring that we do is that we learn the lessons from the experience of CEPA so that other public sector and private sector organisations can learn the lessons from what was a very serious and sustained cyber attack targeted on the organisation. That's taken through our cyber network, which is a piece of work which is led on by the Deputy First Minister to ensure cyber resilience across the public sector in general, but also with the private sector. It's a very strong partnership, and part of that work is about making sure the lessons are learned and that we also help to support other public sector agencies and private sector companies to learn the lessons and to put in place the measures that can help to minimise the risk of them being exposed to a similar attack in the future. So I'd like to reassure you of the work we're doing to try and make sure we learn the lessons from the CEPR attack across the public estate and also for the private sector in Scotland.
That's very important. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Just briefly, if I may, then, Convener, just bringing that back to the budget then. Is there any provision in the budget in relation to ensuring the cybersecurity of public bodies?
There is a lot of the work that's done around cyber security is business as usual for public agencies, and it'd be part of their IT infrastructure funding. So it would be part of what they allocate for their own IT infrastructure. But there wouldn't be a specific ring-fenced budget set by government that is for a public agency to use for cyber security. It would be for that public agency to determine what they need to use from their budget for cyber security purposes, if that makes sense. There is some work that's taken forward. I think it may sit within the justice portfolio around cyber security and the work we do with the National Cyber Security Centre. There's work we do through the Business Resilience Centre, which is based at Stirling University, again to help to support businesses in cybersecurity, which gets, I don't know if it gets funding from the Scottish Government, but we're certainly a partner in it and helping to support it. But there's not a specific budget that is just headline cybersecurity. That would be part of the wider IT budget lines within any public agency.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Back to you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Monica. Let me bring in Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Jackie, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Before I ask my questions, I wonder if I could ask a supplementary on the cybersecurity stuff. And my apologies if this isn't your remit, but you were talking about the public agency and local authorities and what they need to do in regards to the cybersecurity. Can I ask, does the Scottish Government ask them to report back to you so that the Scottish Government have got assurances that they've got business continuity plans and disaster recovery plans in place for that? Because I am aware that that's not always the case.
So, we are stretching my portfolio responsibilities here, but I'm more than happy to take that away. There is a system. So there is a process for agencies to have business continuity plans and also to have recovery plans in place. I'd be more than happy to take that away and come back to the committee with some more detailed written information around this. When I was Justice Secretary, I was involved in the cyber attack, which the NHS faced, not just here in Scotland, but across the whole of the UK. There were a number of hospitals, NHS facilities, which were targeted. And I remember dealing with the Home Secretary at the time around some of our approaches to trying to tackle these issues and the role that the National Cybersecurity Centre has in helping to identify risks and also to provide advice and information. And there was a whole range of work that was carried out off the back of that, that particular piece of work. But I'd be more than happy to come back to the committee with more specific details around the internal processes for managing cyber security within public agencies.
Thank you very much. If I can move on to my questions, it's regarding the transport part of your remit. The STPR2 has got 45 recommendations, and one of them is to achieve a 20% reduction in car kilometres by 2030. I'm used to miles, I'm not quite used to kilometres yet. I think we all recognise that reducing car travel is going to require a step change in how we use our public transport, and we also need to significantly increase the amount of trips we take by using our bicycles, if we have them, or on foot. Can I ask you, Cabinet Secretary, how does this year's budget differ or compare to previous budgets? Because I'm aware that in the 10 years between 1999 and 2019, the distance travelled by the car actually increased. So I'd be interested to hear what the difference is in this year's budget.
So I think in terms of, you'll be aware that we set out, I think it was on the 13th of January or thereabouts, the strategy, the plan we have for tackling, reducing car kilometres by 20%. And that set out a range of actions that we'll be looking to take forward in order to achieve that. I think one of probably the most significant areas of investment that will help to tackle this issue is around the provision of active travel infrastructure. You know, I'm a big believer that if you put the right active travel infrastructure in the right place, people will use it. And experience in other parts of the world would bear that out. Which is why you will see in our active travel investment a very significant increase in active travel investment and a commitment to deploying 10% of our transport budget by the end of this parliamentary session, which will see over £300 million a year being invested in active travel infrastructure and active travel programmes. That's a massive increase over what is a very relatively short period of time. So active travel infrastructure will make a very significant impact, I believe, in helping to reduce car miles and particularly the use of cars for short journeys. I don't just say that because I think everybody will just jump on their bikes. Because the reason I say it is because I also think that if you design, develop active travel infrastructure in the right way, it can produce and deliver better communities, better areas for people to live in. And if you look at some of the big active travel infrastructure that's been built in recent years, it has had a transformational effect on some of the neighbourhoods that have actually benefited from it. I often refer to, as a very good example, as the South City Way in Glasgow, which I've regularly used. It has transformed that area in a positive way. If you look at Sucky Hall Street in Glasgow, it has transformed Sucky Hall Street into a much better, more pleasant place. So it can help to not just tackle car use, but it can also help to create better environments and better communities as well. I think the other area where it's important is that we need to make sure that we are seeing better provision of bus services. So, you know, about 80% of all public transport journeys are carried out in a bus. It is the most flexible, adaptable form of mass transit you can quite literally get, which is why we made the commitment to the Bus Priority Partnership Programme in order to make sure that bus was seen as much more of a priority to create these rapid corridors that could be utilised in a way that would help to improve reliability and speed of bus journeys as well, to make bus travel more attractive to people. Because, you know, when you hear stats like the average speed of a bus going through somewhere like Hope Street in Glasgow is something ridiculous. It's like 4 miles per hour. Why is that? It's because of congestion, very often other problems in the road that actually inhibit it, which then mean that buses are then seen as being unreliable and they're too slow, etc. So bus prioritisation, we're seeing that being taken forward in some local authority areas already, I think can make a big difference in making bus a much more attractive option. And as you mentioned in STPR2, we've set out some really bold ideas and visions around things like the Clyde Metro, the rapid bus transport up in the northeast, and Edinburgh, the mass transit programme, all of which could actually play a big part in helping to support people in making a transition from using their car, particularly for short journeys, to using active travel or public transport. And of course, as of yesterday, our under 22s were able to travel free on buses, again helping to embed behaviours in our future generation to make greater use of public transport. And again, that can help to support us in making better use of public transport rather than car journeys.
Thank you. Moving forward, and you've already kind of touched on some of the next question I was going to ask you. We are hopefully emerging from the coronavirus pandemic. How is the Scottish Government intending to support the rail and bus companies through the next year or so in regards to their recovery and to increase the numbers of users?
So, well, hopefully we are in the recovery phase from the pandemic, although we are still, of course, in a pandemic. But we want to see recovery back onto our public transport system. Clearly, the reductions in numbers which we have seen in passenger numbers over the course of the pandemic have had a very significant financial impact on the sector, which has resulted in the need for a significant level of financial investment from the Scottish Government to help to support the sector. You know, railways are very resource intensive. It's expensive running railways. They are fixed assets, and a lot of money had to be provided in order to help to sustain and support services, even at a reduced level. So in this year's budget, we still have taken account of some of the potential COVID impacts on impact that may have on fare box for both bus and also for rail. So that's been taken into account in our existing budget in the present draft budget. There are risks. We are in the realms of the unknown here. So we can see in rail that leisure journeys are returning pretty much to the levels they would have been at. Probably not quite there, but similar to where they would have been at pre-pandemic, but commuter journeys are nowhere near that as well. Bus, we're seeing some level of recovery there. It's probably recovering quicker than rail, but again, it's not back up to pre-pandemic levels. So there are still pressures, financial pressures on the public transport network as a result of the loss in fare box revenue. We may, during the course of the financial year, depending what recovery in the public transport system looks like and the fare box recovery looks like, we may have to flex some of our budget in order to take account of that. But we are quite literally in the realms of the unknown here because we don't know how quickly the recovery is going to be and to what extent it will take place over the course of the next financial year.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That's all the questions I have, Convener.
Great, thank you very much, Jackie. Mark Ruskell, please.
Yeah, thanks. I mean, maybe just picking up on those themes then around transport. You know, obviously you mentioned the rollout of under-22s concessionary travel. Huge investment, £130 million, I think, allocated in this budget. Then the direct support that's going to the bus companies as well, £54 million up to £99 million. A lot of people write to me about, you know, the quality of bus services, about, you know, services that are going to be closed. And I kind of always point out to them the fact that government is investing a lot in concessionary travel and keeping services running during the pandemic. But a lot of people then get back to me and say, well, that's great, all the amount of money that's being invested. Why don't you just nationalise it? What's your response to that? To that view?
So the response is that there's not an easy answer to what is a complex issue, and that is that there are something like over 250 different public bus providers in Scotland providing access to public bus services. When somebody says to me, well, why don't you nationalise them? That's nationalising over 250 businesses, which comes at a significant cost to the taxpayer as well. So it's not you know, when people think, well, just take it into public ownership and that's the answer to it all. Well, you need the capital and the revenue to do that as well, and we don't have that to make that possible. Which is why, in order to try and address some of these issues, through the Transport Act, we made provision for a range of different measures. So there's the Bus Service Improvement Partnerships. There's a range of options which are available to local authorities, which includes local authority run bus services. But again, a local authority doing that would have to capitalise a company for the purposes of actually achieving that. That comes at a cost to the taxpayer. It's not cost neutral. The money would have to come from somewhere else to buy over the bus company or to buy the buses and to then run it. The franchising mechanism, which is available as well. There is also the mechanism for joint partnerships between public and private as well. So there's a variety of different models which are available there, which I believe that deployed in the right way could help to address some of the issues that your constituents raise with you, and at the same improving services, while at the same time recognising that the idea of us just simply being able to nationalise over 250 companies overnight and to then run it as a national bus service comes at a very significant cost to the taxpayer. And finances are not available for that. So I think what we need to see is more progress being made in the pillars which are available under the Transport Act and to help to support local authorities and how they can go about improving bus services. And we only have to look at some cities where that's already happened, out with Scotland. So if you look at places like Leeds, etc., and everything, they've been able to transform their bus services and the quality of their bus services by giving it greater prioritisation and actually having a much closer bus partnership locally in order to make sure that it's much more reflective of what local needs were.
So one of the tools then in this budget is the Community Bus Fund and the availability of that to start to move these services more in the direction of serving the public interest and being controlled by that public interest as well. Will that be available in the next year? Is that available for councils to bid into and to do that work?
I don't know off the top of my head exactly where we are in local authorities bidding into that fund, but I'd be more than happy to take that away and I can come back to the committee in writing to give you more details on it. But it's the sort of thing that the local authorities would be able to tap into for particular provision around local bus services. But of course, if you have one big local authority that decides to do something significant, it potentially could call upon all of that fund. So we need to make sure that the fund is accessible to all local authorities and that it's not quite simply eaten up by one or two local authorities looking to take forward big projects and big proposals.
A couple of other points then, directly related to the budget. There's been some criticism, I think, from the rail unions about a decline in capital spend on rail for this year. Is this a similar situation to SEPA, that there was a one-off spending at some point and that budgets are going to increase, or does that represent a decline?
So it's a reflection of where Network Rail see themselves as being at within Control Period 6 and the projects that they can take forward in Control Period 6. So as you'll be aware, there has been a significant amount of capital projects that have had to stall or be stopped during the pandemic period. And the way in which the rail system operates is within control periods. So it's more a reflection of where Network Rail think they are in Control Period 6 and what they can deliver over the course of the coming years in the projects that they had intended to deliver in Control Period 6 as well. So that's largely... I think it's where they think there are efficiencies that they can achieve and how they're actually taking forward some of the projects that they will be taking forward within Control Period 6. But overall, this is a budget that is very clear in terms of it's about continuing to invest in our railways in order to improve them, to decarbonise them, and to speed up the network, particularly to our seven cities.
Another issue that colleagues have mentioned is heat in buildings. The renewable heat incentive ends, I think, at the end of March. What I understand from installers, there's a bit of a rush on at the moment for people to apply for RHI and to get installs underway. The question then is, well, what happens after that? Is there going to be a huge demand then for grants or loans that are going to come through EST in that period after March where suddenly there's nothing in place?
Yeah, so there's... So part of this is tied up with the Warms Home Discount Scheme as well, which we've been pursuing with the UK government on what the future of the scheme should look like, how it should operate for some time now, actually over the course of the last year. We've only started to get a response from the UK government on this issue. I hope we'll be in a position in the course of the next couple of weeks to give a clearer indication to the sector on what will happen post-April. But part of this is tied up with some of the work we've been doing around the Warm Homes Discount Scheme, which is operated by the UK government, and the reforms that they're planning to carry out to the scheme in England and Wales, because we want the system to operate in a way that's much more aligned with Scotland's needs. But it would appear that the UK government are not prepared to allow that to happen. So
that's a concern. And then just finally, I think what we're seeing globally is a massive investment in green recovery. European Union's got its Green New Deal package, similar levels of capital investment in the US as well. I mean, with this budget, we are seeing real term capital, you know, decline in capital investment over time. Does that sort of tie one hand behind our back, so to speak, in terms of meeting climate targets? Because if we're trying to get the most out of a capital budget, but it's declining.
So the capital budget we have in this in this budget is reflective of the cut that we've experienced in our capital spend overall. It's over 9% of a cut in our capital expenditure from the UK government. So there has to be give somewhere. So we have to reprioritise. What I would hope you would see is that you can see that we are pivoting our capital investment into the areas that can help to support that green recovery in a much more significant way. And we've sought to protect and invest in these areas. So going back to things like the capital investment we're putting into the circular economy or the investment we're putting into the decarbonisation of properties at £1.8 billion. Again, the investment we're putting into active travel infrastructure, what we're trying to do is to, and rail into decarbonisation of our rail network. What we're trying to do as well as having to sustain a cut in our capital budget is to pivot our capital investment into the areas that will help to deliver on a climate change agenda. So, yes, it has an impact when capital is restricted, but we are trying to balance out in a way that makes sure that it helps to deliver us on our climate change ambitions. And I firmly believe that the priorities we've set out in this budget demonstrate that very clearly. And also highlight the government's real intent to make sure that's the direction of travel going forward.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mark. Cabinet Secretary, we've got a bit of spare time left over because your answers have been so concise, which is always very welcome. A couple of follow-up questions from members. First one for me. While we have you at committee, it would be good to get your response to the UK Climate Change Committee's updated report issued in December last year. Some of the main highlights was concern over a lack of detailed policy guidance from the Scottish Government in terms of how net zero targets will be implemented and delivered, and some concern expressed over the credibility of the Scottish Government's climate change plans. How would you respond to those concerns?
So we're carrying out a piece of work to look at how we'll respond formally to the Committee on Climate Change. I had a meeting with them directly to discuss some of the challenges that they've rightly put to us in our targets and our policy direction. If I give you a recent example of setting out more detail, one of the areas of challenges around was, for example, the reduction in car kilometres by 20%. And since then, we've published details on how we want to progress that and move that forward. But what we will do is we'll provide a more detailed response to the requirements or the points which have been raised by the Committee on Climate Change. I think what the updated assessment from the Committee on Climate Change highlights is that in the whole issue around climate change, we've gone through a process of setting targets or deciding what the targets should be and then setting targets. We're now much more into the delivery phase of things. This is when we need to take forward the measures that will deliver on the targets which will be set. That involves making some difficult decisions. That involves pivoting away from some of the traditional ways in which we've used capital into areas that previously were not as high a priority. And transport's a good example of, you know, ring fencing 10% of the transport budget for active travel infrastructure. It wasn't that long ago, I think, that investment in active travel infrastructure was probably in the tens of millions, not in the hundreds of millions. So it's much more into the delivery phase. And I think the challenge that we're getting from the Committee on Climate Change now is that we want to see much more in the way of detail around delivery. So we're considering that, and we'll be looking at responding to some of the points that they make and looking for us to provide more detail around how we will deliver on some of these commitments.
Okay. And just to follow up a budget question and a question on that, the wider investment in net zero targets, looking at the budget allocated to the Scottish National Investment Bank in 2020 to 2021, it was £241 million. Next year, it's declining to £215 million. I appreciate the bank is not entirely within your portfolio, but in previous committee sessions, you've said that you have a regular dialogue with the Finance Secretary in relation to the bank's objectives. Why the decline then in the bank's budget?
Well, it doesn't sit in my portfolio, so I don't know the rationale behind that. However, and what their profile investment is as well, and what they require. You'll also be aware, and I'm more than happy to take that away and to get further details for you. You may also be aware that the bank are going through a process of looking at how they can raise private finance and levering private finance to the through the bank's process as well, which is quite a detailed regulatory process which they are undertaking. So I would hope that in the course of the next year there would be possibly longer than the next year. Over the next couple of years, we'll see more private finance being able to be levered into the Scottish National Investment Bank. But I'm not cited specifically on the reasons for that, but I'm more than happy to come back to the committee in writing, given that it's not something that sits directly in my portfolio.
No, that would be great. Cabinet Secretary, thank you very much. Let me bring in Fiona Hislop.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, you'll be aware that we're conducting an inquiry into the scale, shape and importance of local government in delivering net zero. And we've heard evidence from them about how they're working with the private sector and also their concerns around their own budget. But clearly, much of your portfolio budget will end up going to local government. And there's probably three different areas. One where they're distributing, and they're distributors on the behalf of the Scottish Government. One where there'll be net zero projects or funds they can bid into that are directed by the Scottish Government. And then a third area might be, and I'm not sure if this does exist, where there's discretionary funding, where funding for net zero can be given to local government to do what they think is best in their area. So I'm not suggesting that you'll be able to, off the top of your head, but very welcome if you can, give us an indication of how much of your budget is in those kind of three areas. But it'd be very helpful if your officials could work with the committee to get a sense and scale of how much of the budget, ideally from this coming year, but if you can't do that, perhaps from this current year, is going to local government in one of those ways. Is that something that would be possible? It would involve a bit of work, but I think it would be helpful because of the importance of local government in meeting the net zero targets.
Yeah, you're right. I'm not able to give you that all off the top of my head. Part of the reason for that as well is because some of it will actually span other portfolios. So I'm thinking, for example, particularly in the in Shona Robinson's portfolio, probably be elements of her portfolio which will help to support us in net zero objectives that we'll see investment get into local authorities. But I'd be more than happy to take the points that you've made away, three points you've made away, to see whether we can provide you with more detail, if that would assist the committee with its inquiry, and come back to you on that, if that would be useful.
Thank you very much. That's very much appreciated. And then the other question I wanted to ask in relation to what we're looking at is, we've heard from community organisations and say town centre development trusts about their difficulty in accessing funding for their projects from local government, but there are funds from national government that they've been able to bid into. So is there anything within the budget for the forthcoming year you can point to saying this will be where community organisations will be able to bid into, and particularly for capacity building and revenue for staffing to help them in some of the projects that can lead, you know, to very, I think, creative but also involved projects that bring people with them, in particular towns across Scotland.
So, just so I'm clear then, so in terms of town centres, is this businesses that are finding it difficult to secure funding for, say, decarbonising their business if they're based in a town centre, or because part of the funding around the heat decarbonisation fund is that it's not just for housing, it's also for non-domestic premises as well, which may be a route for some businesses in towns and city centres.
No, this is from, say, community development trusts that are leading projects within their own communities.
Okay.
Some of it might be house, some of it might be working with businesses. But those very localised projects struggle to get funding from local authorities. That's what they've told us. But they have said that in the past they've been able to bid into national government funds, which must be in your portfolio. So we'd be interested to know what funds going forward will be available for these community development trusts and others to bid into. Mm. And it's not just about capital projects, because some of these are volunteers. Mm. So you know, resource and revenue for staffing can help deliver on the ground projects that couldn't end up being, you know, if you're trying to do heat pumps across a whole town, you might need some kind of town leadership from the Community Development Trust and others to really help lead some of these projects. Some of them might be very small, but some of them could potentially develop, I know from my own experience in my own constituency, into something quite significant.
Yeah, another example on that could be around things like district heating systems as well.
Yeah.
So, and you know, trying to facilitate and bring that together, it would require some resource support to try and get all the different interested parties together to take forward a scheme of that nature. But look, why don't I take that away as well, and I can come back to you with more details on some of the specific funding pots that may be available at a national level that that community-based organisations could apply to. You'll be aware of the climate hubs that we're creating, which is to try and help to create a much more sustainable approach to changing local communities to tackle the climate emergency. The first of those two are already up and running, and we've got plans to roll out further climate towns. So that might be one of the routes for some towns and some communities, but it might not always be the case. But I can get further details on these for you, and certainly the other funding pots that might be available. But I also think it's worth thinking about some of the other funding pots that may not sit in my portfolio that can help to deliver programmes that assist us in meeting our net zero targets as well. So because it won't all come through my portfolio, some of it will sit in other portfolio areas, but I can take that away and I can ask officials to pull together some of those details for you.
Thank you very much. And Blackburn in my community is one of those climate towns that you referred to.
There you go.
Convener.
So.
Great stuff. Thanks, Fiona. Liam Kerr, please.
Convener. Just to pick up on something earlier, Cabinet Secretary, you were asked about the heat and building strategy and the £1.8 billion by 2026. Now, the capital spending review states that the government will invest £1.6 billion to decarbonise heat and buildings. Can you explain to the committee why is there that difference? And in any event, which portfolios are going to get that money? And can the committee have a detailed breakdown of the proposed spending profile to 2026?
Sure. So the £1.6 billion was on the basis of the draft heat and building strategy at that time, and following the consultation and engagement around that, the revised figure was £1.8 billion. Some of that sits in my portfolio, some of it may sit in the housing portfolio as well, but I'd be more than happy again to come back and give you, if you ask for, a much more detailed breakdown and how that will be broken down between the portfolios, if that would be useful. So I don't have that to hand. Liz Kerry, you have details on that?
I don't have the further detail, but we can come back on that.
I think the committee would be very grateful, Cabinet Secretary. Final thing, very briefly, if I may, Natalie Don asked what I thought were very good questions about the lack of progress on a circular economy. Now, you mentioned and in your answers to her an intended circular economy bill. Now, I think that was first proposed in 2019 and was restated in the 2021 programme for government. Can you give the committee any update on when we can expect to see the circular economy bill?
So, and you'll be aware that we withdrew that bill on the basis that it was in order to, well, it was criticised on the basis that it was viewed as not being ambitious enough and driving forward the circular economy sufficiently. So the decision was made to withdraw and to look at it reintroducing a piece of legislation. That's just part of the background to the bill itself. I would expect that bill to be in the early part of this parliamentary session. I can't say much more than that because we have to go through a process in government in agreeing landing slots for bills coming into parliament and for our future programme for government. But I can assure you that it's viewed as being one of the priority bills within this parliamentary session. Given the importance of making progress in this particular issue, I'm very much of the view that it needs to be one of the earlier bills in the Parliament. So I would hope, without going much further, it would give you reassurance that it's going to be one that will be in the first half of this parliamentary session.
Very grateful. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Liam. Just a supplemental on that, Cabinet Secretary, in the area of heat and buildings, Last week, the committee heard from private capital providers, and what one of the concerns expressed, and also expressed by local authority leaders, is the potential lack of scale across some local authority areas that would attract, you know, global capital, private capital, and also a potential lack of data in terms of what assets exist, where those assets are. That would be the kind of first, that would be the starting point in terms of local authorities identifying their housing stock that needs to be retrofitted. There seems to be a lack of progress on both points. So the question for me would be, what role can the Scottish Government play in helping local authorities get that data, get that inventory of assets that will need to be converted by 2030? And is there a mechanism in place or plans in place that would allow the Scottish Government to look across local authority areas and suggest combination of assets to attract private capital? I appreciate there's a bit in there, but given that the target is 2030, you know, there's not a huge amount of time.
So was a lack of data an issue for the private sector companies, the potential investors?
Yes, it was.
Yeah. So I would expect local authorities to have a reasonable understanding of their housing stock. Well, they should have a good understanding of their housing stock, as should social housing providers in general. And they will have they will have knowledge of which of those have actually had retrofit energy improvements carried out to them, whether that be through the area-based hearing schemes or through other schemes. So they should have a level of that data. I wonder whether the issue may be is that there is data that some of these private sector investors are not able to access or get an understanding of, rather than actually there's just no data there. So, point one, let me take that away and check that for you, convener. The second issue here is about scale, and this is an issue which I've discussed previously with some potential private investors who have said that, you know, we need scale in order to make the type of capital investment that we believe is necessary to make it financially viable to deliver a programme. So one of the areas that we are alongside the financial task force that I mentioned earlier on will be able to look at is what do we need to put in place in order to help to lever in some of that private sector investment. Some of that might involve, for example, and I've discussed this in my previous portfolio when I was a minister responsible for cities, is how can we actually maybe bring together some of our cities to form alliances or partnerships in looking to try and help to put forward joint proposals that would give the sector the scale they're looking for. You know, so the Edinburgh and Dundee or the Glasgow and Aberdeen type partnership, actually a shared prospectus and going to the private sector to see whether it's of a scale that they could then deliver on. So I think it's a reasonable challenge from the private sector, and it's an issue that's been raised with us, and it's an issue that the Financial Task Force can look at, and then we need to then think about how do we create the right type of partnerships to assist with that. And the final point I would make is that that's one of the areas that the Public Energy Agency can help and support with, so that where there are local authorities or social housing providers, some social housing providers might only have a couple of hundred houses. They won't have the scale to get the level of private sector investment they're looking for. They might get, they'll get public sector investment, but not necessarily the private sector investment. Do we need to bring some of them together to offer it in a scale that actually can then attract the level of private sector investment? And again, that's a role that the agency can help to support us in going forward in the years ahead, just given the scale of what we have to achieve there.
I appreciate that response. I think just to clarify, the concern over data was partly private sector capital, but also a recognition by local authorities that they still have a bit of work to do in terms of that, in terms of that data. And I think that goes full circle back to the initial discussion we had about a lack of resource and expertise at local authority level. So do you see a role of Scottish Government or the Public Energy Agency in actively getting involved to assist local authorities? And I guess this goes back to the point about the scale of investment in the Public Energy Agency, the amount of resource in the agency, and the fact, as you say, it will take a couple of years to get this up and running to full tilt. My concern would be that will take us to, you know, 2024, 2025, which, you know, means the clock's ticking very quickly down to the 2030 target. So my question to you would be, is there any plans to accelerate this the Public Energy Agency to make it a real urgent priority?
I don't think we need the agency for the purposes of getting the data. So, you know, local authorities should be able to draw that data together. But let me take away the point you're making, and that is, if there's a lack of data there, why is there a lack of data, and what would need to be put in place in order to improve the quality of that data? And would there be a need for resource to be provided in order to allow local authorities and also social housing providers to deliver that? I'd like to think social housing providers, the housing association, that will be in a different place from local authorities, because very often their housing stock will be of a much smaller level as well. I may be wrong there, but I would like to think that would be the case. It would have a much more detailed understanding of the improvements they've already carried out. But let me take that away, and let's try and find out why there is that lack of data and what can be done to try and improve that. Because I agree with your point. I think the danger is that we wait for the Public Energy Agency to get up to tilt in helping to coordinate some of this, when actually we're losing time here. And there's actually investors that are looking to make investments just now if they can get access to the right information, the right data. So we need to take that challenge on. But I'm happy to take that point away, and to try and get a bit more of a detailed understanding, and also what we can do to try and help to address the issue as well.
Yeah, that would be great, Cabinet Secretary. That's appreciated, because I think it goes back to your point. Perhaps the first 50, 60, 70% has been done, but as you well know, all the 100% of the assets need to be financed. So it's not a case of most of them having covered data. You know, all of it needs to be covered.
Yeah. No, I get the point you're making, and I think it's a reasonable challenge. So I'll take that away.
Great. Well, look, I think that brings us to the end of questions. It brings us to the end of our allocated time. We very much appreciate your time, Cabinet Secretary. We've covered a lot of ground. Thank you to you and your officials for attending committee this morning. And I will now briefly suspend the meeting for the next agenda item. Thank you.
Hi, just to make everyone aware, I'm going to be putting on the next panel's cameras, just so you're all aware.
with supplementals. Okay, welcome back, everyone. Agenda item 5 is our first consideration of evidence on the draft of the Scottish Government's fourth National Planning Framework, NPF4 for short. A number of committees are joining in scrutiny of different elements of NPF4. Our focus today is on how effectively NPF4 addresses energy policy, particularly in the context of the national commitment to achieve net zero by 2045. I'm pleased to welcome the following witnesses to our committee meeting this morning. Dr. Niall Kerr, Interdisciplinary Research Fellow, Energy and Climate Policy, University of Edinburgh. Morag Watson, Director of Policy, Scottish Renewables. Elizabeth Layton, Secretariat, Climate Emergency Response Group. And Kirsten Land, Senior External Relations Manager, SSEN Transmission. Welcome, everyone. Thank you very much for taking time out to join the committee this morning. And thank you to those who have provided submissions to the Parliament's call for views, all of which have been noted. We will now move on to questions, and let me start with the first question, which I would like to put to each of our panel members. One of the main themes running through NPF4 is to prioritise localisation across a number of policy areas. This committee is undertaking a major inquiry into the role of local government in delivering net zero targets. So I'd like to ask each of you, how important will local authorities be in meeting net zero targets across areas including transport, procurement, circular economy and decarbonising heat? And what do you see as being the main challenges faced by local authorities in meeting these targets? Let me go in the order that I introduced the panel. So that would be Niall first, Morag, Elizabeth, and then Kirsten. So Niall, over to you, please.
Yes, hello, and thank you for the invitation to give evidence to the committee. On the question of the role of local government, currently, as the committee is already aware, there are local heat energy efficiency strategies that are being piloted and designed for local authorities alongside the Scottish Government. So it's set up for local authorities to have a key role in heat decarbonisation energy efficiency planning in Scotland. As you are also probably aware, local governments need to have the necessary budget and expertise to be able to address the achievement of heat decarbonisation. They have a focus on social housing. That's an area that they have a key role in helping to achieve heat decarbonisation. But there's various aspects of heat decarbonisation, not least the private housing stock, whether that's owner-occupied or rented, that local authorities have little, if any, control over, especially with the existing stock. And so this is an area where there's going to have to be a significant contribution at the national level, regulations associated, funding and financial incentives to implement the necessary changes. So well, this approach, this kind of local strategy approach, is something that is seen in formal approach to local strategies, is something that's seen in other countries. One of the countries I'm looking at the moment is heat decarbonisation in the Netherlands, where a very similar approach to local planning of heat is taking place. There's a formal requirement for municipalities to prepare their strategies there as well, and that very closely mirrors the situation in Scotland. So yeah, to sum up, a critical role as part of local heat and energy efficiency strategies, but there are pretty obvious limitations to what local authorities can do to achieve the full extent of the target on their own. And there's a really important role for national and local government to work together. And that's a key feature of heat decarbonisation more generally, is the need for coordination between various parts of government and various public agencies.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kerr. Same question to Morag Watson, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, committee. It's nice to be speaking to you all. We share the concerns that were voiced extensively in this morning's session around the capacity and the budgets that are available to local authorities. They have a very key role in us meeting net zero, particularly around the areas that you outlined. Research that we've carried out in Scottish Renewables, looking specifically at the planning aspect of what local authorities do, has shown since 2011 the number of planning staff in local authorities in Scotland has dropped by 20%. Our main anxiety going forward, where we go from here, is around how local authorities will be able to cope with the huge upswing in activity there's going to need to be if we are to achieve our net zero goals. So, given my the organisation I speak on behalf of, I will stick to renewable energy just to illustrate this issue. So we currently have 8.5 gigawatts of onshore wind in Scotland. By 2030, to keep us on track for net zero, we will need 12 gigawatts in addition to the 8 that we already have. We have around 0.5 gigawatt of solar. We will need 4 to 8 gigawatts by 2030. And in offshore space, we will be going from 1 gigawatt to 11 gigawatts. And all of that has to come onshore. All of those projects need to go through the planning systems, of which local authorities are a key part. Given that they are already overstretched at the moment, if we see this big upswing in work, we have deep concerns around that. We also have very deep concerns for local authorities around the staff that they actually have and the experience of them. We're seeing many of the experienced planning officers retiring, the new people coming into the system. They're so pressured they don't get out to do the professional development they should maybe have done in the past. We see a shortage of ecologists, landscape architects and all sorts of specialist skills, leaving local authorities struggling. So they do have a very key role to play. They are very important stakeholders and partners in all of the work that we will be doing, but we have deep concerns about their capacity to take on what we are going to have to do with the situation that they are currently in.
Thank you very much, Morag, for that response. Same question to Elizabeth Layton, please.
Hello, thank you for inviting me. Hello, a bit of feedback there. Okay. Inviting me along, Secretariat for the Climate Emergency Response Group, which is a leadership group of business and civic leaders, including my colleague Morag Watson, who have come together to urge the Scottish Government to take a more urgent and ambitious response to the climate emergency. And in September, we published a report that included 12 proposals that could be taken forward immediately, and one was on planning and one was on the local government role and delivery, so very pertinent to this discussion. Absolutely, local government is critical to achieving our net zero ambitions. They are estimated to have powers over about a third of the emissions in their area, so transport, housing, planning. And so that pivot to delivery that the Cabinet Secretary was speaking about in previous sessions is absolutely reliant on local authorities being equipped and having the capacity and the resources to do their job. In the area of planning, that was one of our main recommendations about making planning fit for a net zero future, was gearing them up in this year of 2022. So that planners, councillors, reporters, the whole planning system actually has the capacity and expertise that is fit for purpose. And it's not that we don't, in a sense, know the answer to this question, because a very good piece of research was done for Skills Development Scotland that identified the fact that, you know, it said the evidence and data suggests that this sector may struggle in the future to attract and retain a sustainable workforce for the planning service, and that this would put at risk achieving national objectives, including achieving net zero emissions by 2045. And that report includes an action plan about how to address this. Published in February 2021, what's happened with the action plan and what's being done, as you yourself were saying earlier, convener, the clock is ticking. This is an urgent issue that needs to be addressed now. So we need emergency measures on addressing that gap in capacity, as well as longer term skills development over, you know, 4 or 5 year horizon to fill those gaps.
Thank you very much, Elizabeth. And same question to Kirsten Land, please.
Good morning, committee. I'm here today on behalf of SSEN Transmission. So we're the company that owns, operates and develops the transmission network in the north of Scotland and also the remote Scottish islands with the aim of delivering a network for net zero. We are a regulated business, and so our key role is to connect the renewable energy that's needed to support the UK and Scotland's emissions reductions targets, connecting that energy to the grid and taking it to where it's needed all across GB. I think our network area in the north of Scotland in particular will play an outsized role in meeting the UK and Scotland's renewable energy targets, contributing up to 10% of the UK net zero target, according to our own analysis. And through the current price control RIIO-T2, we are planning to invest at least £2.8 billion between now and 2026, potentially increasing to over £4 billion to deliver our network for net zero in the north of Scotland. And in doing so, obviously looking to kind of double our workforce between now and 2026. However, as has been referenced by a number of other panel members, delivery timescales are incredibly challenging, and the levels of investment required to support net zero are going to be absolutely unprecedented. I think our network has probably not seen this level of investment since perhaps the 1950s. So there's going to be a significant investment needed in Scotland's grid infrastructure between now and 2030. To deliver these targets at scale and pace for net zero. And planning will obviously play an absolutely pivotal role in that. I think just to echo the comments that other panel members have made before me, I think successful delivery of MPF4's net zero objectives will be absolutely dependent on a supportive planning process that is responsive to the levels of investment that is going to be required to achieve Scotland's climate goals. And I think having adequate levels of planning resource is going to be absolutely vital to unlock this. Obviously, there's recognition within the MPF4 document that increases in planning fees are planned to help address this issue. But we feel that increasing fees on its own won't support better quality and timely decision making without further investment in resource and skills planning. As Morag mentioned, that you know that the trend is that the number of planners is actually decreasing at the moment. And we're already kind of feeling the impact of that in terms of the consenting timescale for our current projects. I think the other thing that would be really helpful is to have the with the fee increase for planning fees is to have those ring fenced so they stay within local authority planning teams. And we think that that could perhaps directly improve planning determination outcomes.
Thank you very much for those opening remarks. Let me pick up on two issues raised. First of all, concerns on planning capacity and expertise at local authority level mentioned by Morag, Elizabeth and Kirsten. How much will this be a bottleneck in terms of approving the various projects and capacity that will be required to meet targets? And what needs to be done in terms of better resourcing local authorities to help them reach net zero targets? And a separate question for Dr. Kerr. Dr. Kerr, I know you've looked at decarbonising heat in other countries. The evidence we've heard from local authorities indicates concerns about reaching the heat in buildings target for 2030. Some of them said that might not be achievable at all. Do you share those concerns? And if so, what practical policy measures need to be put in place to help local authorities meet the 2030 targets for heat in buildings? So first question on planning. Let me go with Morag, Elizabeth, and then Kirsten. Over to you, Morag. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. So in terms of how we address this, we know that our colleagues at the Royal Town Planning Institute are already researching into what the skills demand is going to be going forward for the planning system. And they are calling for a strategic skills and workforce development plan for Scotland, and we fully support that call. So we're looking for that to come forward. We have already heard this morning from the Cabinet Secretary that there is a very constrained financial situation that we find ourselves in due to the pandemic and many other factors. So while it is desirable that local authorities should funding for this, we understand that that is not always as straightforward as you'd want it to be. One of the things that we see in the planning system is there can be a lot of repetition. So again, sticking to the area of renewables, what we will see is the time frames in planning take so long that by the time you have gotten your onshore wind farm consented, the model of turbine that you got in your consent is no longer on the market, newer models are available, and you have to go back through the planning system to get it reconsented with the turbines that are now available. So we will see churn like this going through the planning system. If we can streamline our processes more, so our planning system is predictable and can deliver consents rapidly, we would actually take a lot of the strain off the planning system by having to go back and revisit planning applications again and again. The other thing that we are doing research with at the moment and working with colleagues in the Scottish Government on is how we reduce planning timescales. We need to start front-loading what we are doing and doing pre-application consultations. This means that everybody has had a chance to comment on an application before it actually goes into the system, and any changes they would be asking for can be made pre-application stage. What we're finding at the moment is people are waiting to comment when the application is actually live. That means that the application then has to go back to the drawing board to take in their comments, and this again takes up a huge amount of capacity in the system. So if we can unlock that and stop using capacity just to go back over the same ground again and again, that really would make a sizeable difference in our planning system.
Thanks very much, Morag. That was very helpful. And Elizabeth, same question to you on planning.
Sure, thank you. Support what Morag had said about the RTPI work that they've been involved with Improvement Service and Skills Development Scotland. I mentioned that report on the workforce planning, but obviously that's more of a medium to long-term answer. So it's what can we do in the meantime? And I think some learning can be done from COVID and how resources were accessed and people were redeployed, people were brought in from other professions to support the COVID response. And so I think some of that has to be considered for the planning workforce, which is declining, as several have mentioned. There are other ways to do some of the work in preparation to make planning decisions easier. For example, the local heat and energy efficiency strategies that have been mentioned will be so critical to guiding planning decisions. And yet, you know, many of them still are not in place. And local authorities, I think, have probably given evidence to your committee to say how difficult they see it will be completing that task by the expected date. So I think more support needs to be given to them now, not waiting for the Public Energy Agency to be in place, but upfront, to make sure that those are in place as soon as possible, because they will guide many of the decisions where they don't have a lot of expertise on energy master planning. And the same would go there in terms of heat networks. Here's another example of where the example of the heat partnerships could perhaps assist with some of building that expertise and sharing that resource across some local authorities. Another need will be guidance and how to do carbon assessments and how to assess whether a project will be resilient to the impacts of climate change. And that guidance could be brought into play relatively quickly by using some of the guidance that's already being used for city and growth deals that is being used with project managers. And again, that would be useful for planners. So it's making use of what we have now, rather than duplicating or reinventing the wheel, working regionally, working in partnerships, and coming up with these immediate solutions, as well as that resourcing that longer-term workforce planning. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Elizabeth. And same question to Kirsten, please.
Yeah, I don't have a huge amount more to add as to what's been said already by fellow panel members. I think probably a key bottleneck for us, just sort of picking up on the sort of skills point in terms of having expertise within local authorities and you know, that kind of differing between different local authorities. For us, that really hits home in terms of the biodiversity side for our developments. We are, as a business, we're committed to delivering a greener grid. We tend to focus on habitat restoration and creating biodiversity growth as we invest in our network. And through that, we've committed to deliver biodiversity net gain on all of our new sites by 2025, targeting a no net loss at the moment. we find that when we're engaging on biodiversity with local authorities, because there isn't the skills availability is very varied, and there isn't any sort of guidance at the moment to kind of give local authorities a direction in terms of what standards of biodiversity should be achieved. We're experiencing really a real inconsistency in approach. So you're getting different expectations at different local authorities, and it differs from project to project on what should or shouldn't be delivered. So at the moment, there isn't the way that policy 3, the nature crisis, is drafted in the NPF4 document, there isn't an agreed set of standards that's outlined in there. And we think that that should change. There should be a bit more of a direction within the NPF4 document so that it can give local authorities that guidance. And we're already experiencing this impact quite greatly in our projects. And the inconsistency creates delays as different people have different expectations about what should be delivered. So I think greater clarity in NPF4 would definitely help to reduce that bottleneck.
Thank you very much, Kirsten. That was very helpful indeed. And Dr. Kerr, I asked you a question on heating buildings, but feel free also to respond to the question on planning if that's something within your remit.
I'll focus on the question of targets that you put for heating buildings. So I think it's fair to say that the targets, I think particularly for 2030, are hugely ambitious. I did a little bit of work recently that looked at heat decarbonisation policy, things like incentives and regulations, but also targets in different European countries. And from that, Scotland has, in that selection of countries, the most ambitious heat decarbonisation targets for 2030. It's also starting at quite a low base in terms of the amount of properties that are currently using low carbon heat. We've had incentives such as the renewable heat incentive in place, various schemes to support heat networks in place for years, and that's resulted in a certain amount of uptake, but nowhere near the amount of uptake that will be needed to achieve the 2030 target. So the point is that, yeah, the target is undoubtedly hugely ambitious and will be difficult to achieve. I suppose the more interesting question is whether a highly ambitious target for 2030 is something that helps to promote effective implementation of the things that we need to do ultimately for 2045. So there's an undoubted moral imperative to implement heat decarbonisation and to decarbonise as quickly as we can, to address climate change as immediately as we can. I think there's also a belief that there will be potential economic gains from moving quickly on those decarbonisation, and that if Scotland is moving particularly quickly, it can seek to develop the industries and the companies of the future and achieve economic impacts and export potential from these technologies. The two key heat decarbonisation technologies that will be playing most of the role in the 2020s are heat pumps or some form of electrified heat and heat networks. Low carbon gases in the gas grid is not something that's foreseen to really have much of a prospect of being introduced until possibly the 2030s, if it is to be introduced at all. Heat pumps and heat networks are both technologies that are well established in other parts of the world. So the economic impacts that could be secured in Scotland from their implementation is not clear. There are various other countries that are more well-versed in putting in heat networks and the companies that exist within those looking to implement in Scotland. So, as I say, the targets are definitely hugely, hugely ambitious, some of the, if not the most ambitious in Europe, particularly for 2030. And there's a moral imperative to try and achieve them, but the economic impacts that can be achieved from moving particularly quickly are kind of up for debate. There's technologies that will be introduced in the 2020s, but as I say, they're perhaps not technologies that Scotland is leading in, although there are other technologies, supplementary technologies, such as energy storage technologies and the use of data to improve heating technologies and the performance of heating technologies, which is an area where Scotland possibly can excel and produce some companies that are valuable and create economic impact for the future.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kerr. That was very interesting and helpful. Let me bring in Fiona Hislop.
Good morning. I'd like to address policy 19 within the National Planning Framework 4, and I'll come first to Maura Watson and to, then to Kirsten Land. Scottish Renewables in their submission are clear that they don't think that this policy will ensure a place to support continued expansion of low carbon and net zero energy technologies, and you go as far as to say there's a fundamental mismatch between the Scottish Government's energy policy, particularly the offshore wind policy statement, and NPF4. Could you please expand on that? And then I'll come to Kirsten after that. So Morag Watson first.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. So, as we said in our submission, we've been absolutely clear and unequivocal about this, that the draft text of the National Planning Framework 4, as it stands, will not deliver the level of renewables deployment that we need to keep us on track to achieve net zero. What we will say about the NPF4 is the high-level principles are excellent. The key principle that addressing climate change and nature recovery should be the primary guiding principle in all decisions and plans is exactly what we need. Throughout the NPF4, it asserts the key role of more renewable energy in delivering net zero. We absolutely agree with that as well. Where the problem comes is when you start to look into the detailed text of the document. So, for example, around climate change and nature recovery being primary guiding principles, there is nothing in the document that provides any guidance to a planning decision maker about how you should operationalise that and what that should mean in practice. When you start to look at the text around renewable energy in particular, it's often ambiguous, a lot of it is contradictory, it's unclear. And when you compare what is in policy 19 with what are in other policies, particularly around scheduled ancient monuments, around forestry and around peatland, those policies are in conflict rather than trying to work together. This is why we are saying that there does need to be a fundamental rewrite of several sections of National Planning Framework 4 if they are to deliver the ambitions. And as I say, to reiterate, we are fully supportive of the ambitions of the National Planning Framework 4. But we are extremely doubtful that the text as written will deliver what ministers are aspiring to do.
Can I come to Kirsten Land, what her views are on 19?
Yeah, I'd thank you. I totally echo that. I think there is some really positive things in the draft. Morag obviously talked about the sort of overarching objectives, and we certainly welcome recognition within NPF4 of planning's role in tackling the climate and environmental emergency, which is mentioned throughout the document. We're also really, really supportive of the inclusion of renewable energy and transmission infrastructure as national developments, which I think helps to strengthen their role in tackling the climate emergency. But as Morag said, where we have specific concerns is the detail of the specific policies in the document, which will ultimately be what determines how successful NPF4 will be on delivering for our future low carbon needs. So significant investment in renewable energy and grid infrastructure is going to be needed, and NPF4 will need to really lay the groundwork for a very clear and responsive, flexible and well-resourced consenting process so that the timely delivery of that infrastructure can be delivered at the pace and scale to meet net zero. I think, just to echo Morag's point, I think the way it's currently drafted, it doesn't quite deliver this. The policies on wildlands and green energy are quite contradictory, which is the feedback we've had from our generation customers, which is very unhelpful to them from a decision-making perspective and creates huge blockers for further renewable energy development. And as a stakeholder-led business, obviously connecting renewable energy in the north of Scotland, we recognise and advocate on behalf of those industry concerns regarding the misalignment between what is proposed, particularly in the onshore wind policy statement and also NPF4, that sends a really conflicting message to industry and also planners, which any sort of uncertainty will just create risk to net zero delivery. From a transmission perspective, the policy that we're particularly concerned about is the forestry and woodland policy, which the way it's currently worded, there's just absolutely no flexibility at all, would make it extremely difficult for us to deliver our critical grid investments due to the extent of woodland coverage within our operational area. We think rewording, redrafting will be required in several policies within the document, just to give a much clearer direction in support of net zero targets and just be a bit more clear in terms of supporting net zero goals.
And just a short follow-up on this, you referred, Kirsten, to the the national development sites. Do you think they're too restrictive? For example, Cromarty First, Nigport isn't even mentioned.
We're quite supportive of the ones that are listed. I mean, our key focus was obviously ensuring that the transmission network retained its status, because we do think it will be critical in supporting the transition to net zero as a kind of backbone to connecting the renewables that's going to be needed to support that. I think that perhaps comments on other national developments might be better for maybe other panel members, but I don't really have any other additional comments.
Thank you, and I'll turn to other panel members, and I'll come first to Dr. Kerr and again then to Elizabeth Layton, and again on policy 19 and the I suppose it's the alignment with pursuing net zero along with other requirements in relation to Nature Scotland, Immunity, Historic Environment Scotland, and how can we ensure NPF4 supports that simultaneous assessment and perhaps the early intervention and work with, for example, Historic Environment Scotland, as already happens, for example, major transport schemes, should that be applied to energy aspects? And just also on the and policy 19, how should small-scale renewables be assessed and viewed in designated areas, and should support be given to community-owned projects, and how does this help or assist that, or what improvements are needed to help small-scale renewable projects? So first to Dr. Kerr and then to Elizabeth Layton, and feel free to comment on anything you've heard.
I've been focusing on policy 11 with respect to heat and cooling. I'm kind of prepared for that. I haven't maybe got so much to say on policy 19. The first things to say on coordination with respect to heat decarbonisation, but I can save those for later time.
Happy to pass on to other areas, but it's more that coordination with other areas in principle. What if you've got any overarching views, and then other members can pick up in specifics.
There was a few things, as I say, in relation to focusing on heat decarbonisation and coordination, obviously being extremely important part of that that I think the draft maybe overlooks at the moment. And this is something that maybe Kirsten might want to speak on as well. But there's next to no reference to the role of electricity networks in heat decarbonisation at the moment. So in the heating section, it discusses how heat networks will be implemented and how new developments need to consider their proximity to a heat network. But the targets for 2030 and will involve a huge amount of electrified heat, predominantly probably heat pumps, if they're to be achieved. And the implementation of hundreds of thousands of heat pumps is going to require an electricity network that is able to accommodate that. And there's expectation that there probably have to be some degree of network reinforcement. And as I say, at the moment, the draft talks a lot about heat networks, but it doesn't seem to make any reference to the importance of the electricity networks being able to provide electrified heat. As I say, if targets are to be achieved, there'll be hundreds of thousands of properties using electrified heat. And the other thing that's possibly missing in terms of coordination is the new build heat standards. This is for new developments, new domestic properties and non-domestic properties to be using low carbon heat by 2024. And this is, as I say, not currently mentioned as far as I can recall in the draft, but it's the kind of underpinning policy for low carbon heat networks to be connected to new developments, and as I say, new developments and electrified heat. but it's not mentioned, I don't think, at all at the moment. So and that connects to the point or the coordinating point on electricity networks, that if new developments are to be low carbon or use low carbon heat from 2024, there may need to be an electricity network in place that can accommodate, or at least the potential of heat pumps in individual buildings or heat pumps running a heat network for these new developments. And that's it. It's kind of point on coordination that, from my point of view, this planning framework is really all about, is by connecting different areas of government. But that's something that, as I say, is not really addressed in the planning framework at the moment. So yeah, the point on the role of electrified heat and connecting role of electricity networks with new developments, I think is the key coordinating point that I think is missing from the planning framework at the moment.
And if I can come to Elizabeth later, if she can maybe comment, if you can, about that coordination. If we wait for everything to be aligned and coordinated, we might not actually get started on what we need to do. So a general view on that would be helpful. And anything you have about how we can help support small-scale developments and whether NPF4 encourages that or what needs to be done to help improve that.
Yes, thank you. I agree completely. We can't wait for everything to be perfect to get on with it. I'll speak about the point about buildings and historic environment designated areas, because I do think that that is a bit of an odd man out in the national planning framework, as it doesn't really seem to give a nod to the change that's been made of giving significant weight to the climate emergency and planning decision, the thresholds that are placed in terms of historic assets, places, it seems unnecessarily restrictive, and unlike some of the other sections, referring to no adverse effects rather than, you know, other language used elsewhere about no unacceptable adverse impacts or, you know, and really setting it in the wider public interest in addressing the climate emergency. And it doesn't seem to chime with the heat and building strategy, which says that they are there is a review of permitted development rights underway and work on developing approaches for historic buildings and places to transition. So I would have liked to have seen it to have been much more indicate that there was a shift in how we were going to respect the culture and the integrity of our historic places, but at the same time acknowledge that they need to adapt for climate impacts as well as in terms of reducing their emissions, and that they can. And I would think Historic Environment Scotland would actually support that. So I'd like to see change there and clarity provided that on that, so that planning for zero emission systems, particularly micro renewables, in conservation areas should be much easier and you know, more of a given, more of a presumption in favor of that than all the hurdles that people have to go through now that seem rather out of date. So that's in terms of the coordination question. And on community projects, again, that they would, I'm not aware of much mention that's made there in terms of, you know, community assets, but I would imagine that, you know, again, clarity on making it, you know, easier for these groups to apply for planning, if there's more upfront support and assistance so that they can get through the planning process more quickly and easily, that would be important. And a final point on clarity is, I think setting, it's not just the language that is in the NPF4, the actual words like must versus should and will versus may, that we'd like to see stronger language, but also being aware of this coordinating with targets and other government strategies that can be enabling and give confidence to planners behind their decisions in favor of net zero. For example, in the Green Policy 19, if the government had a target for solar, as they are consulting on now for onshore wind, that would strengthen the case, I think, for planners to make those decisions and acknowledge that significant weight to the climate emergency. Thanks.
Thank you very much. And I know Historic Environment Scotland have founded a global heritage network on climate change, so perhaps they're more willing, perhaps, than people might perceive. But I'll pass over to the convener now.
Thank you very much, Fiona. Let me bring in Liam Kerr to be followed by Natalie Dawn. Liam, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I will direct two questions to Dr. Kerr, but if anyone else wants to come in after he's answered, just indicate if you would. Neil, you talked of heat networks and Policy 11. Now, Policy 11 appears to prioritise heat networks, or what people may know as domestic heating, over other technologies. And I think there's an actual presumption against domestic biomass where heat networks are available. In your view, does this strike the right balance between heating technologies and site-specific solutions? And does it sufficiently recognise other solutions for heating that may be more financially viable or indeed practical?
I think that it, as currently written, refers to heat networks unduly. But the way that I understand heat policy and other Scottish documents, that there isn't such an emphasis on heat networks. There's reference to multiple different options. But I think it's a problem with the draft text at the moment, is that it's written really, it mainly refers to heat networks. But as I mentioned earlier, there are policies such as the new build heat standard, and that the policy is that from 2024, consented new buildings will have to have low carbon heat, and that could take a variety of different forms. So there are heat network, plans for heat network zones, and that's what's referred to in the planning framework, that if you are in a heat network zone, then there's a presumption that you use that network. But it seems to me that the initial policy to think about is the new build heat standard, and that new buildings consented from 2024 should be using some form of low carbon heat. Whether there's much, competition between biomass systems and heat networks, I suppose a couple of things to say there. The advice from the Committee on Climate Change is that, advice from various organisations is that heat networks are more efficient and have better operational costs and upfront costs per household attached in heat dense areas. So they're much more likely to take place in heat dense areas. So generally, we're talking about cities or perhaps large towns. In other countries, there are heat networks in all sorts of different parts of environments. In Denmark, there's heat networks in many small towns. The way that heat networks are thought about in this country at the moment is in heat dense areas and cities. The advice from the Committee on Climate Change is that biomass systems shouldn't be implemented in urban environments, partly to do with the local pollutants that are emitted from biomass boilers. And so biomass boilers are meant to be, at least according to the Committee on Climate Change, reserved for rural areas where a heat pump is not considered appropriate. There is also the potential to use biomass systems to run heat networks, which is something that is happening in Denmark and in Sweden, with this carbon capture and pollutant capture considerations there. So the main point is that in the draft document, there is seemingly an undue emphasis on heat networks as a low carbon heat option, and there are different options that need to be considered. Need to be made reference to, as I talked about electrified heat, and you've talked about biomass heating systems. The new build heat standard allows the opportunity for many different types of low carbon heat, and there seems to be an undue emphasis on heat networks currently. One more point I'd like to make on the new build heat standard, which is a little bit of a divergence, but I think it's an important thing to remember with the new build heat standard. So the policy, as far as I understand it, is that by 2024, new buildings consented from 2024 will have to use low carbon heat. So as far as I understand it, that allows the potential for a building to be consented prior to 2024, but then built after 2024. And there are examples which have been raised with the UK government of how house builders in 2018 were building to 2013 standards in about half of the developments that they were carrying out. So if that was to happen with the new build heat standard in Scotland, i.e. 5 years after the regulations come in, new developments were still being developed to the old standards, that would have pretty serious implications for achieving the zero carbon homes 2030 standard. So it's a point about the policy coming in 2024, but it only being for buildings consented then, and what the implications of that might be. They might be that new developments are not actually fully low carbon for 7 years after 2024. The implications that has for the very ambitious 2030 targets is something that needs to be considered.
Thank you for that. I can't see if anyone else wants to come in, so I'll pose another question and perhaps we can coordinate that shortly. You referred, Neil, earlier on to how industrial developments with waste or surplus heat are expected to be co-located with areas of demand. And demand, of course, we know that a significant proportion of that will be domestic heat. In your view, how can we strike a balance between using sources of low carbon heat and building houses where people actually want to live? And just thinking about your last answer, is that addressed anywhere else? Is I think what I'm hearing from you, as we've seen in, for example, Scottish Renewables submission, is that there's a feeling that this has been drafted somewhat in isolation. So is there anything else that we need to be aware of in this space?
I'll take that before, maybe before if anyone else was coming after. But on the point of co-locating with waste heat is regularly identified as the, one of the lowest cost, if not the lowest cost option for supplying heat to heat networks here and, you know, in various parts of the world. But it's not something that's really taken advantage of properly in Scottish or UK heat networks. So one of the parts of the paragraphs in the planning framework refers to co-locating future waste heat sources, future potential waste heat sources with heat demand to ensure that that, you know, waste heat source can be used to run a heat network and supply low carbon heat to the properties. There's a couple of things to consider there with regards to future developments. That the main, as far as I understand, the main waste source heat in Scotland, or the largest one, is wastewater treatment. And you may not want to site new wastewater treatment plants near to heat demand for various reasons. The other thing to think about is the production of hydrogen, which I've been reading about recently, may result in large amounts of waste heat. And that is perhaps something that could be sited near to sources of heat demand. And therefore that the production of hydrogen, perhaps for use in industry, produces a lot of waste heat and therefore helps to feed a heat network nearby. That provides a low-cost heat source for the heat network, but also possibly provides a source of revenue for the hydrogen production. So in hydrogen production, there's various kind of regional considerations as to where the production may take place. And there's a potential for waste heat from that, which could help provide synergies for low carbon heat networks.
I'm very grateful. I believe Elizabeth Layton may want to come in on this point.
Yes, it's coming in more on the previous point about the heating and cooling and the number of technologies that are addressed. I just wanted to, you know, raise our attention to the fact that we know the government is planning to introduce regulations not just for new build, but also for existing properties to transition to zero emissions heat. And so that's yet another reason why it is important that individual technologies and the full range of technologies is not neglected in Policy 11 or on heating and cooling, historic assets and places, Policy 28 or Policy 19 in terms of green energy. So that's yet another example of alignment with strategies that needs to be made. Thank you.
Thank you. That's very helpful. Morag Watson.
Thank you. Just to throw some light on how the heat is being treated in planning and what we're looking for. We're looking to other government documents, you know, to do that strategic thinking about what technology should be used where for doing decarbonisation. And what we're looking for the MPF4 to do is provide that enabling policy framework for gaining consents for whichever projects are most appropriate in the most appropriate spot. The reason that we're seeing a lot coming through on heat networks in MPF4 is they are a relatively new development in Scotland, and we are aware that many planning authorities haven't dealt with applications around them. We're looking for the MPF4 to create that guidance and framework for a policy for a planning decision maker when an application comes forward. But what we would not be looking for the MPF4 to do is to attempt to provide any kind of strategic guidance as to which is the most appropriate technology. And in policy discussions, we are hearing these things begin to be conflated. We would expect building regulations to deal with what heating should be used in a new property. We would expect permitted development rights to enable what needs to be retrofitted to an existing policy. And when it comes to bringing forward a large new scheme that will need planning consent, we'd expect the National Planning Framework 4 to be that enabling framework to enable that to happen. And we would expect government's heat strategy overall to be doing that analysis of what is the most cost-effective and net zero responsive way to decarbonise our heat demand. But what we are seeing in these policies is they are beginning to conflate together, and we don't feel that that's helpful. Thank you.
I'm very grateful to the panel. No further questions, Camilla.
Thank you very much, Liam. Let me bring in Natalie Dawn, please. Natalie, over to you.
Thanks, convener. So my questions I'll direct to Kirstan and Dr. Kerr for my first question. It's quite general. So obviously the National Spatial Strategy sort of focuses on different areas in Scotland. And I'm just wondering what your views are on what impact the strategy will have on energy production and consumption. And do you think it will support a radical reduction in greenhouse gas emissions? What do you feel that the key barriers are to delivering the six principles of the strategy? And how do you feel that promoting and supporting active travel and decentralising energy networks can be delivered justly?
So, yeah, I think we're supportive of the spatial strategy. I think it's particularly the inclusion of the transmission network on the spatial strategy map, which includes the progression of future remote island links, which we think is going to be really important. I think it's probably quite important to note that the projects shown on the map don't include all of the strategic transmission investments that are going to be necessary to support Scotland's net zero ambitions, such as reinforcements to the grid network in Argyll and Skye, the East Coast HVDC link, and many others. And that will obviously change as well as things move forward and as the need for other reinforcements in the network come forward as we make the journey towards net zero. So, I think that's very important that there's a bit of flexibility there. I think the priorities that are listed for the spatial strategy are probably the right ones. I think the overarching objectives of the MPF4 plan as a whole, we're wholly supportive of, and we think they're the right things to focus on. It's more the detail of the specific policies that we have concerns with, because they don't align with the messaging that's in things like the spatial strategy and the sort of other parts, the action areas of the document too. So I think that's all I have to say.
Okay. Thank you.
I wouldn't be so familiar with the principles of the spatial strategy, so I'll just focus on the point about the just transition and something that's been mentioned occasionally, but maybe not properly in the meeting so far, is the targets for fuel poverty, which have been recently revised with a new definition and a new target date for achievement. But there have been some form of target for fuel poverty in Scotland and the rest of the UK for probably 20 years now, and it's not really had the policies have not had a huge amount of impact. The definition has been revised, and that sort of affects how it's recorded and reported. There's still the generally I think it's about a quarter of the population of Scotland is considered to be in some form of fuel poverty. So how we address that in the in a very similar time frame to how we at the same time move to low carbon heat is makes what is a significant challenge even more challenging. And I suppose the point is that it's really important to recognise the scale of the challenge, because that will, I think, help to focus minds and think about the most effective means of achieving both affordable energy and low carbon energy. It's just a point that there are fuel poverty targets alongside low carbon targets, and the achievement of both is going to be incredibly difficult, but the scale of the challenge should hopefully allow minds to be focused and to think of perhaps kind of somewhat radical ways of how heat and energy in general is paid for, how the system is run, because it might require some quite radical thinking to achieve both the targets simultaneously.
Definitely. Okay, thank you both. I'll direct my next questions to Elizabeth and Morag, but if you want to pick up on any of my previous points, feel free to. So in terms of the spatial strategy, do you feel that the priorities that are set out for each of the five areas are appropriate, given that all the spatial principles some we've touched on already also apply to these areas or regions, sorry? And do you feel that there's a risk of or a lack of clarity for the public and private sectors and communities as well? And how do you feel this should be overcome?
Hello, thank you.
Hi.
The clarity issue is one that we've quite majored on quite strongly, because we think that in addition to the actual framework itself, that there's a lot of that the government can do to show leadership and provide that clarity and certainty, not just for the planning system, but also for the investors, as you said, and with the spatial strategy, but also with the national developments that are in the framework, that we think there's a need to align infrastructure investment plans and the ones that we have already, but going forward, Scottish budgets, to show that there is a genuine plan and commitment to taking those forward and working with the private sector to do so. We already know that in previous national planning frameworks, some of those national developments, it didn't come forward, and some indeed are carried forward to this one. So we think that would be very important in terms of providing that clarity and bringing in the private investment. I think that's all I'll have to say on that. Thanks.
Thank you, Elizabeth.
Thank you. So again, Natalie, picking up on your question about the ambiguity around it, we have no concerns per se about what's in the spatial strategy, but when you look across them, they are quite inconsistent. Some mention renewable energy, some do not. As Kirsten has already said, there are some very major part of the grid infrastructure that are not there. And when you look at those sections of the MPF or document in comparison with all the other sections, it isn't clear how they relate to each other. And having looked at those sections again, it's not clear how someone who is making decisions in the planning system could view those and take what is in those sections into their decision making. And this would come to another overarching concern we have about the MPF4 in general. There are many important priorities in there, as has already been mentioned. There's fuel poverty, there's the need for decent homes, there's the need for a just transition, there's the need to protect the environment, there's the need to address climate change, among many others. But there's absolutely no hierarchy anywhere in the document to give any kind of guidance of how do you balance out these things. We want all these priorities to be delivered, but we want them to be mutually reinforcing. So we do them in a joined up and coherent way, but at the moment there's nothing to join them up and create that coherence. So we're actually in danger of all our priorities that are so important to us competing with each other and actually beginning to undermine each other, rather than being a mutually reinforcing thing that delivers the Scotland that we all want to see, which is low carbon, it's a thriving nature, our communities are thriving, we have community wealth, we have a just transition, people are no longer living in fuel poverty, but we're not seeing how that all comes together in a coherent way from what is currently there. We think it can, it's just that potential has not yet been realised.
All right, thanks both. That's very useful to know. I'll pass back to the convener now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Natalie. Let me bring in Monica Lennon to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Monica, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. We know that there are 18 national developments proposed, including key developments for the energy sector. And I was reading Scottish Renewables' written submission to the committee, which Elizabeth Leighton's just touched on this very point, that several national developments from NPF3 have been carried forward to NPF4. And I'm going to come to MORAG first, but Scottish Renewables say to the committee that designation as a national development provides negligible benefits within the planning system, and cites those projects from NPF3 being carried over as further evidence that national development designation does not work as a planning mechanism. So I'm going to come to MORAG just to get you to maybe elaborate on that and to ask what you see as being the key barriers to these national developments being realised.
Thank you, Monica. This just picks up on the theme that's developing through this, that it's very welcome that we have these national designations to reinforce their importance. But again, it doesn't really follow through into the planning system of how does that get treated in the planning balance. If you're a decision maker and one of these developments is coming in front of you, if it has this designation, how should you treat it differently from any other consenting application that comes forward? That's not clear. And we think this is the underlying problem of, we have this category into which we put things, but it isn't clear what that category means. So what we've seen in the past, as you very clearly said there, things that were under National Planning Framework 3, is those national developments still haven't been consented, they still haven't been done. You would think that being a national development would confer some kind of advantage in the consenting process, but case evidence would be that it does not. So that is something that we would be looking to address in the NPF4. If these things are of national importance to us, then we should have a process by which they're treated as nationally important, and there's a it weighs somehow in the planning balance. So, you know, it is obviously open to debate as to how it should weigh in the balance and how much weight should be afforded to it, but it should certainly have some kind of weight attached to it, which it does not currently appear to do.
Thank you. I've already mentioned Elizabeth Leighton, so can I turn to Elizabeth next, please?
Yes, just to say that the national developments are not in the programme for government, they're not in the infrastructure investment plan, only a few exceptions to that, like digital fibre. So then it makes you wonder, well, how are these going to happen? And then what confidence again does this give to the planning system in terms of the significance of these and addressing the concerns that MORAG was raising? So I think it's so important to see this document, the framework, in the context of those wider decisions by government in their budget statements or in the forthcoming National Economic Transformation Strategy. I think it's particularly significant in this case of do these all add up to the same picture being promoted to give that confidence to the planners, but also to investors. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Sticking with the same question and these themes, can I turn next to Dr. Kerr to get your view on that, but also in your opinion, how important are these national developments in relation to energy production and consumption in terms of, hopefully radically reducing greenhouse gas emissions? Dr. Kerr, please.
It's not something that I'm that aware of. It seems that the points that MORAG is making seem very sensible, that if projects which were national developments in 2013 are not yet in development, that seems that some serious consideration needs to be given to the weight that the designation carries, but it's not something that I'm particularly expert on.
Well, thank you for that. Can then come finally to Kirsten Land, please, just to get your thoughts on that, Kirsten. You're still on mute, so you'll have to repeat your answer again.
Sorry about that. I just wanted to say I support the feedback that other panel members have given so far. I think as a business, we're obviously very welcoming of the fact that transmission infrastructure has been included as a national development, because it does give you know, sort of added strength or weighting within MPF4 as a type of development that's going to be, you know, fundamental to support net zero delivery. But I guess my point comes back to the policies again, because the way the policies are kind of drafted in MPF4, some of them are creating blockers for national developments to actually go ahead the way that they're drafted at present. And you kind of see within those policies that there's potential for kind of direct kind of sort of inconsistencies between them, but also some are not very detailed in terms of what they're actually trying to deliver, which makes it difficult from a decision-making perspective and provides inconsistency in decision-making, I think. I think in particular, I talked about the policy for trees, woodland and forestry previously, but that is certainly a huge blocker for transmission infrastructure as a national development, the way that it's currently drafted, because although we do try to, if we have to remove a tree, we always look to replace any trees that we remove, and we also try to not remove any trees if we don't have to. We're very supportive of a desire to limit any impact on forestry and woodlands, absolutely support that, but there's just no flexibility in the wording of the policy at the moment. It could be possible. It's not always possible for us to not develop in an area that is woodland, because just in the nature of where we develop our projects in the north of Scotland, there tends to be woodland cover in our operational area. So I think that the lack of flexibility in some of the policies is already creating a blocker to the development of national development projects. Within that policy in particular for woodland, I think there should be an exclusion made for essential infrastructure, obviously where there's a locational need if there's no other option, if no other site is suitable. At the moment, there's no sort of recognition of that within the MPF4, and it would be helpful to do that, I think, in the context of net zero delivery and delivering national developments in future.
Thank you. I can just return one final question. I'll just aim this one at Morag Watson, because I think Morag, you said earlier on that we need to start front-loading in terms of, you know, how planning decisions are made and how the public engage. Can I just ask you to elaborate on that and what is the missing link? Because from my understanding, we've been talking about front-loading and planning for a very long time now. So what is missing? Is it resources or is it something else?
One of the key things that we're hearing, particularly from the statutory stakeholders, is that it's a capacity issue for them. They just don't have enough time. But it does end up being one of those catch-22 situations. So in planning, there's always been a pre-consultation phase where it would be normal for our developer members to go to those statutory consultees and to the community and to test the idea with them, to hear their thoughts on it. And then based on the feedback they get, you redesign your scheme. So you've addressed concerns that people had before you even go into planning. But when we're constrained and there is a requirement for those statutory consultees to respond to planning applications, but not to pre-consultation, obviously they have to meet their obligations, so they will put their emphasis on what they have to do, which is respond to a planning application. But the catch-22 then comes in that planning application isn't quite what they would have wanted. Had they been able to engage in the pre-consultation stage, it probably would have been a lot closer to what they wanted. But because that's not what's happened. You then, as I said earlier, go back through the process. If it has to be revised, resubmitted, everybody has to look at it again. If there are more comments from another statutory consultee, another set of adjustments needs to be made, and it all goes round again. And we just end up in this loop of going over the same ground again and again as we make adjustments to meet everybody's needs. And that could be prevented, but at the moment it's a capacity strain, but then it creates a bottleneck further down. So as I say, it's a catch-22 at the moment that we find ourselves in.
Thank you. No, that's helpful. I mean, I know that for the national developments, you know, that status means that the principle of those developments don't need to be agreed in the later consenting process, but they still have to have relevant statutory consent. So on paper, it looks like it should be a quicker process, but there might be other reasons why some projects are not getting off the ground. Points of time, so I'll hand back to the convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Monica. Next up is Jackie Dunbar, to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Jackie, over to you, please.
Convener, and good morning, panel. If I can go back to a question that was touched on earlier for more clarity, and it's regarding the Scottish Government's offshore wind policy statement. I think some of the panel said that changes were needed to be made to be made to align the NFP, the NPF4 and the OWPS, but you didn't actually say what you thought those changes should be. So if I could maybe dig down a little more, I'm sorry, I can't remember which panel member actually said that it did need change. But can I ask Morag for her comments on that first, please?
Absolutely, yes, I can respond to that one for you. So what we will see in the future as we move towards net zero is that our offshore wind industry becomes the backbone of our energy generation infrastructure. And what we will see is all of that has to come onshore. There will also be operations and maintenance centres and so on happening. And particularly when we have looked at the strategies and the spatial area plans that are in the NPF4, they've often not included the huge amounts of development that is going to be happening offshore adjacent to those areas. So, as Kirsten has already said, grid infrastructure is going to be important as we bring all that electricity that's generated, and particularly in the northern North Sea, into the East Coast. There will need to be grid infrastructure that will then transport that electricity to where it's needed. And again, we're not seeing that coming through in that joined up thinking of just what we will need to consider as we move towards 2045.
And maybe this is an unfair question, but how do you see that developing? What's needed for that to happen?
Right. In terms of practicalities written into National Planning Framework 4, we need to particularly get it down on simply included in the policy is the first step to make everybody aware and the planners aware that this is happening and this is going to be something that will develop over time. And as we've said in many other places, there needs to be guidance on how this should be treated in the planning balance. That offshore generation capacity is going to be key to Scotland's low carbon energy generation in the future. It's also key to our just transition as we transition from a fossil fuel based energy system and much of our economy, depending on that, into renewables. So again, this will be a very new thing for our planning decision makers. It will often be something they've not come across before. And what they'll be looking for is the NPF4 to provide them with guidance of how should they be thinking about it, what kind of decisions are they expected to make around it, and how should they weigh those decisions against other considerations in the planning balance. And that's what's missing at the moment.
Okay, thank you. Kirsten, do you have anything to add?
Sorry, just getting myself on mute. No, I agree with them. Agree with everything that Morag's raised. We're obviously the company that's responsible for connecting the projects. ScotWind's going to be a huge focus for us as a business, I think, moving forward. And I think the coordination point is particularly important to connect these projects in the most efficient way, but also kind of reduce impact on communities wherever possible. And yeah, I agree with what what Morag said. I think that's right.
Okay, and if I can just touch on that as well, can I ask, do you think that we should need some regional framework, or should it be all national? You know, because some regions may need different to others is what I was trying to get at.
Yeah, well, I think NPF4 does touch on that a little bit. They do seem to have sort of split up different regions with different priorities within the document. And I think from looking at the detail within NPF4 at the moment, we didn't really have any huge concerns about what was proposed. But what I would say is that there's certain generic priorities that are featured in some of the areas and not others. Like, for example, biodiversity, it's only referenced in a couple of the action areas. It's not in all of them. Again, the transmission infrastructure isn't referenced across all. It's only referenced in, I think, the islands, which makes sense. That's obviously a key focus in terms of improving resilience and supporting their journey to net zero too. But we think that perhaps that should be recognised across all of the action areas in Scotland, because the transmission network will play such a key role in that transition to net zero, and I don't think that's recognised at the moment.
Okay, thank you. Back to you, convener.
Thank you very much, Jackie. Mark Ruskell, please.
Yeah, thanks. I mean, if I could just sort of follow on from that, actually, maybe turn to Kirstan first. I mean, I think, you know, previous iterations of NPF, we've had, you know, specific transmission projects like Beauly Denny being cited as national developments. I mean, it seems that this NPF is a bit light on specific infrastructure projects that are needed and where they're actually going to be. And thinking about, you know, 25 gigawatts from ScotWind, 10 gigawatts of onshore wind, I don't know, from solar, maybe 6 gigawatts from solar. I mean, as a transmission business, are you looking at this and thinking, well, actually, there's about five bits of major chunky transmission infrastructure that needs to be written in to this NPF, or is the wording in here, the detail in here, enough at the moment?
I think it's important that the wording remains quite flexible, because, as you say, there's going to be a lot of investment required in the transmission network, and we obviously know what projects we have as priorities just now. That we're keen to take forward as a business. For example, the East Coast HVDC link, which will be actually absolutely crucial to deliver ScotWind projects. We've got investments in Argyll and Skye that we're looking to take forward, connection of the islands as well, Western Isles and Orkney, key for us to do. But I think the key thing is that as further investments come forward, as further projects need to come forward in order to meet renewable targets, we might find that there's more projects that come on board that we need to progress as well. So I think at the moment in the plan, there is not so much name reference, but drawn on the map in terms of projects for transmission that are key, but there are also ones that aren't included on there that are equally as important. So I think keeping that flexibility is right, because it gives us that flexibility to progress to other investments that need to happen. I think if we just list the key projects, and that could potentially be problematic for future investment.
Okay, but I mean, is there potential conflict? Is there potential, you know, limit on capacity for transmission, and therefore, you know, you may have projects competing against each other, onshore versus offshore versus solar? Is that a realistic prospect, or does NPF allow everything to be built out?
It obviously depends on a project by project basis. We are obviously hugely reliant on the planning process in order to take forward our projects and ensure that they're delivered in a timely way. It's obviously one of the factors that we have in delivering the projects. I think as long as NPF4 is supportive of the delivery of transmission infrastructure, just making a couple of the tweaks in terms of rewording to some of the specific policies in there, particularly the sort of biodiversity side and the woodland policy in particular, would make a huge difference and just try and remove some of the blockers. But I think that can be delivered if NPF4 is just tweaked a little bit.
I don't know if Morag wants to come in on this specifically.
Certainly. Thank you, Mark. One of the things that we've been calling for that we really think the MPF4 needs to do is it needs to have a much stronger relationship with other Scottish Government policies, particularly around energy and net zero. So we're expecting the MPF4 to govern planning for 10 years, and we know in that 10 years there's going to be a lot of dynamic change as new information comes forward from the Climate Change Committee and advice and research. How we are moving towards net zero is going to have to evolve and change. And one of our key concerns around the MPF4 is if we start to write, as Kirsten has said, if we start to put specific things in there, but as more data comes forward, we realise those things need to evolve and change, the MPF4 needs to be flexible enough to accommodate that change going forward. One of the things we think is very helpful is the Scottish Government starting to set targets. So they're consulting around one for onshore wind, for example. We know that they're starting to look at a strategy for solar energy in Scotland, which would hopefully bring forward a target. And again, that gives our planning decision makers an understanding of the scale of what it is that needs to happen. And likewise, it gives us an opportunity to monitor how are we progressing towards those targets. Is planning an enabler? Is planning a blocker? And again, if it proves to be a blocker, that gives us the opportunity to evolve our policies and our advice, make sure it no longer becomes that way. So, as Kirsten says, as a business, SSEN does have a very clear plan of what infrastructure is needed. Through the ScotWind process, for example, we do know what the pipeline looks like going forward. We will know what the pipeline looks like going forward for onshore wind, and we need to be able to support and facilitate those things rather than planning becoming a blocker to them.
Thanks for that. I mean, if I could just stay with you, Morag, I mean, I think it was in Scottish Renewables submission, you were talking about, you know, visual impact being perhaps the main reason why renewables are turned down. I'm just wondering what, from an industry perspective, what changes then you're looking for in the way that projects are assessed, and who is responsible for that? Is it Nature Scot? You mentioned very briefly wildland earlier on. Are you looking for a change in the way landscape is assessed? Because it seems that that is the major contention, if there is a contention, because public support are very strongly in favour of onshore wind, but that's the main reason why projects are being turned down or why it's taking a long time for them to get through planning. So what kind of changes are you specifically looking for?
That's a really interesting question that you ask, Mark. What we do see when we look at why planning applications, particularly for onshore wind, are turned down, the vast majority of them are turned down on visual impact. Now, us, Scottish Renewables, as the industry body, have commissioned independent research. The UK Government has commissioned independent research. And it is consistently found that the public support for onshore renewables, particularly onshore wind, sits around that 70 to 80%. And again, when we have specifically surveyed people who live within 5 miles of a wind farm, we find those very high levels of public support. So people do not seem concerned about how they look. We recently, there was a report came out from Bigger Economics, specifically looking at the question of, do having wind farms present impact on tourism? Because we know that's, again, a big concern about how they look. And they found there was no relationship between the two, and actually tourism had gone up in the areas where there were more wind farms. So it weighs disproportionately in the planning balance. And this brings me back to the very first point that I made to the committee. There is no guidance in the MPF4 about how we should be considering climate change, the climate emergency, in the planning balance. We know very clearly that we need more onshore renewables to hit our targets, and we know that we are going to need to consent them. But if we keep refusing them based on a minority of people who object to how they look, we are never going to get there. So the Scottish Government itself says in the MPF4, we must radically change the planning balance. That's what needs to happen. We all agree. They've said all the right priorities about how it needs to be rebalanced. But again, back to that original point, there is no guidance on how that should happen and how a planning decision maker should do that. And it's essential we get that balance, that guidance in, so we stop having this very disproportionate skewing of the planning balance decisions.
Okay. And in terms of like the materiality then of climate change vis-a-vis landscape, I mean, is that the primary kind of way to in your view, kind of rebalance decision making? Or are there other aspects? I mean, you know, it's been proposed in the past that community economic benefit could be a material consideration in planning.
Material consideration in planning is a very interesting one, and it comes up a lot. And essentially, for people who are less familiar with the legal decision making around it, material considerations are a group of things that just essentially get placed in the decision making basket and balanced up against each other, which to date that has been a very prudent approach in our planning system. But now we are in a climate emergency, as Elizabeth says, we need to move to an emergency balance in how we think. Climate change is not equal with all other considerations. It is a serious threat to us as a nation and more widely. And as a nation, we were one of the first on the earth to declare a climate emergency, and we are taking this very seriously. That needs to be reflected in our planning decision. We can't treat climate change as just the same as all other considerations anymore, any more than we can do so with the biodiversity emergency. As the Scottish Government has said, they need to be the prime considerations in decision making, but we need guidance on what that means. We do just need to start consenting things that will move us towards net zero. And there's also the question mark of, do we cease to consent things that actually increase our emissions? And that's where the decision making around balance and guidance needs to come.
Okay, just a couple more brief questions. So it was just a wrap up question, actually. Again, if I could stay with Morgan, then I'll invite others to come in if they want to wrap up on anything that I've asked. Like you mentioned earlier on to colleagues about local planning and some of the constraints there and the capacity and resources of local planning. Is this an issue also with Section 36, Section 37 planning as well? So with government planning processes, or is it just about local authorities and their role as planning authorities for smaller developments that don't meet that threshold?
We have seen a big issue with timescales in the Section 36 process. So while there is guidance on how long the public local inquiry should take, there isn't guidance on how long it should take the reporter to write up the report once the public local inquiry has taken place. And we have no timescales for how long it should take the minister or the cabinet secretary to then decide based on the report that they have received from the reporters. During the pandemic, we saw that decision-making stretched from 9 months to 27 months to make a decision after a public local inquiry. At the moment, the time frame for making a decision around planning from the first conception of a project to consenting is 7 years. We have 8 years to hit our onshore wind targets. The two just don't go together. What we see in England, for example, is there's a 3 month time frame for the reporter to write their report, and then there's a 3 month time frame for the minister or the cabinet secretary to make their decision. And we think it would be exceptionally helpful if we had those kind of timeframes established in Scotland.
See how any project is investable if it takes 7 years to get a decision. Okay, I just wondered if Niall or Elizabeth had anything to add. I know this isn't perhaps directly in your area of expertise, but if you wanted to come in on any of those. Elizabeth?
Yes, just quickly, 2 points. One is on this balancing language. I pulled out a couple of points on what's actually in the text of the MPF4. It talks about, you know, what shouldn't be supported. And they talk about, you know, the level of emissions is the minimum that can be achieved for the development to be viable. And it is also demonstrated that the proposed development is in the long-term public interest. And one might question, you know, how could something that's actually going to increase our emissions or not really support our transition to net zero not be in the long-term public interest? So I think that's an example of the type of language that is not as helpful as it could be of really giving a strong push on what significant weight being given to climate emergency should be. So that's an example there. And then I wanted to give one other example, and that would be about the leadership issue and giving more confidence to the planning system, is that we've called for the Scottish Government to make a statement that they will call in major developments where they believe the climate impacts have not been properly considered. And that would be in terms of emissions reduction, but also in adapting to climate impacts. And we think that would send a very strong message to the planners to know that if they're making decisions that they think are risky in terms of, you know, the way we think of planning now, that they're going to be backed up. Or if they don't, if they go with business as usual, that they're going to be called out. And I think that's a really important leadership role for the government to take.
Thanks. I don't know if Niall has anything to add to that. If not, I'll go back. Yeah.
No specific points to make on those issues.
Okay, thanks.
Great, thanks very much, Mark. Dr Kerr, I do have a very brief final question for you. The supplemental question. The Scottish Government has created the Public Energy Agency to help implement the heat and building strategy. But as we heard today, it's a virtual-only agency, has no additional budget or resource, and will not be up and running until 2024. Very briefly, is this enough in your view? Is this enough resource and support to help meet the 2030 heat and buildings targets?
I think it's fair to say also a point that was made with respect to this earlier is that things are ongoing. They don't rely on the National Public Agency to happen. And hopefully that'll be the case. There's some Scottish incentive schemes and regulations coming in, and they don't rely on the National Public Energy Agency. But bearing in mind what I was saying about the scale of the challenge for low carbon and for fuel poverty targets, I think a really important point for people to be aware of is the scale of the challenge. And with that in mind, perhaps it might be more critical that a coordinating body, whether that's a public energy, what exact form that takes, a coordinating body could be prioritised, could be brought in quicker, perhaps. But it's important to think about what exact role that body will have, and that's something that the Scottish Government are doing at the moment. But considering the scale of the challenge, and if that body is going to play a critical role, yes, I think it's fair to say that that body should be in as soon as possible if it's to play a critical role.
Thank you very much. That brings us to the end of questions and our allocated time. Thank you to the panel once again for joining us this morning. Thank you for your time and enjoy the rest of your day. Next week, the committee will have one more evidence session on NPF4, looking at transport, the environment and the circular economy. We will then share our findings with the lead committee towards the end of this month. Thank you very much. We will now move straight into the next agenda item, which is the consideration of one negative instrument, the Greenhouse Gas Emissions Trading Scheme, Amendment Order 2021. Like the affirmative instrument we considered earlier, this is a joint instrument between the four UK administrations. It amends the UK-wide Emissions Trading Scheme, established by the Greenhouse Gas Emissions Trading Scheme Order 2020. This is a negative instrument laid under the negative procedure, which means its provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees a motion to annul it. No such motion to annul has been laid. I refer members to paper number 6 from the clerk. I have to put on record that paragraph 10 requires a correction. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this instrument on the 18th of January and determined that it should formally draw the Parliament's attention on the ground of a defect in the drafting of the instrument. However, it also welcomed an assurance that the Scottish Government was working to correct this with other administrations. So let me ask, do members have any comments on this instrument? No. There are no comments. I therefore invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Are we agreed? That is agreed. Thank you very much. I now close the public part of the committee meeting. Thank you.